It's a battle against Syracuse. That game's coming up at the top of the hour.
Today's Sports Century Classic Moment is brought to you by Budweiser.
Statement games, cupcakes, surprises, woodsheds, enough. Conference time has arrived with a vengeance. Penn State and Ohio State square off in a Big Ten big'un. Last week, the Pac-10 was taking a beating. This week, they're all on the run for the roses. And it's shakeout time in the SEC. Tennessee goes to Auburn. Florida heads for Tuscaloosa. And the Dogs swagger into Death Valley. Even Conference USA gets in the mix as Tulane makes its play for the title. An end to unfamiliar faces and strange surroundings. It's conference time at last.
NC State lives and dies with a big play. Fortunately, they have Torrey Holt, the receiver, the Seminoles' nemesis. But Syracuse brings playmaker supreme Donovan McNabb, the early Heisman frontrunner, along with a couple other guys. The Orangemen trying to avoid that upset down in Raleigh. In the meantime, welcome to Thursday game night presented by Coors Light. Chris Fowler along with Lee Corso and Kirk Herbstreit, the over on the deuce. Minutes away now from Jamie Barnett and the Wolfpack trying to pull their second big upset of the season when Syracuse comes calling. Coors Light. This week's bulletin board, proof that a picture is worth, well, a lot when it comes to team motivation. NC State beat Syracuse 2-point conversion in OT last year up in the Dome and then celebrates a little too long for the Orangemen's liking right on the Syracuse sideline. Now, Kyle McIntosh said that privately his teammates have not forgotten the scene here in this game as they head south for the rematch where Mike Tirico and Mike Gottfried are standing by for a preview, guys.
Well, Chris, when we were up in Syracuse this week, Mike, the players said they're not making it as big a deal of the revenge as you would think because they have still national championship aspirations. Why? Because of Donovan McNabb. What makes him so good, Mike?
Mike, he's a phenomenal athlete, number one, and he's strong. He's 6'2", 225 pounds, and benches over 300 pounds in the bench press. And you see his completion percentage. He's only thrown one bad pass in 76 attempts. He's good at throwing on the rollout. He hits Rob Conrad with a touchdown. Very accurate from the shotgun or under center with the deep ball. As he rolls out to this side, squares his shoulders to the line of scrimmage and makes that throw. And what makes him the most dangerous, Mike, right here, running the option play. He's a very dangerous runner on the option.
A few teams ask their quarterback to do more, and McNabb does it, but he's going to have to do it against a good group. Lloyd Harrison, Tony Scott, the DBs for NC State, they call themselves the Rough Riders. 10 interceptions in 3 games this year. Chris, great atmosphere. We'll see you soon from Tobacco Road.
Ask the Seminoles if Carter Finley can be tough. Coming up, our Thursday game night audibles. Quick hitters from Corso and Herbstreit on the weekend's games when we come back.
Thursday game night is presented by Frost Brewed Coors Light, who reminds you the three most important words are, hey, beer man, and by Taco Bell. Want some?
Syracuse, NC State, Mike Tirico, Mike Gottfried. Enjoy the first half. We'll see you at halftime.
Chris, thanks, and welcome to the field where North Carolina State knocked off then number 2 Florida State. They try to do it to number 11 Syracuse tonight in a game headlined by two of college football's brightest stars. Each team has a magic man of sweet moves who can really, really rock the house.
Good
start of the college football weekend, Thursday Night Football, Mike Tirico, Mike Gottfried. We throw around the word best probably far too often, but it's legit tonight. Maybe the best all-around quarterback in the country, Donovan McNabb. Why has he put himself on that plane this year, Mike?
Mike, Donovan McNabb is an outstanding quarterback. He's a very accurate passer. He takes a lot of pride in his ball handling. And the big thing, he's 6'3", 220 pounds. He's a strong running back on the option. And his coaches talk about he's thrown 76 passes, only one bad pass, only no interceptions.
Troy Edwards, David Boston, Peter Ward. They're a bunch of really good wide receivers. If you haven't seen Torrey Holt, you're going to put him in your best list if he has a normal kind of night tonight.
Mike, all coaches will tell you there's sometimes a quarterback can beat you or a running back can beat you. Very rarely a wide receiver that can beat you in a ball game. George DeLeon, the defensive coordinator of Syracuse, said he's a guy that can beat us by himself. He does a great job of getting away from bump and run coverage, which you'll see tonight. He adjusts to the football very well. He'll hit the quick screen. They move him around a lot to try to keep him away from bump and run coverage. He's equally dangerous returning punts, and he shows you his strength here on this collision, keeps his feet, and scores a touchdown. The North Carolina State coaches said that he's the fastest player at North Carolina State in football pads.
And he is something special. If you saw Thursday game night, you know Holt caught the last pass when these teams met. For more on that, here's Dr. Jerry Punch. Doc?
Thank you very much, Michael, and hello, everyone. You know, after last year's remarkable come-from-behind overtime win by North Carolina State, both teams realize that tonight's rematch has grown to almost rivalry proportions. For the Orange Men of Syracuse, it is all about revenge. Revenge for a second-half collapse, they say, should have never happened. For the Wolfpack of North Carolina State, it is about remembering how special that night was and will always be.
All I remember is streaking down the sideline when we caught the two-point conversion. We caught it on their side of the sideline, and I just streaked up the sideline with a lot of excitement and was just happy, you know, that we overcame all the odds, went up there and proved that we could play football.
It gave me a build of confidence that I could lead my team against anybody and we could win.
Torrey Holt and Jamie Barnett are typical of the Wolfpack players who head coach Michael Kane has turned into believers. Believers in a program whose signature week in and week out has been one of courage, composure, and remarkable second half comebacks. Mike?
And Mike, that game last year, part of the reason O'Kane got a just deserved 4-year contract extension. They backed that up with a victory here over Florida State earlier this year. On the opposite side, Syracuse head coach Paul Pasqualoni. He's 4 wins shy of Dick McPherson for second on the all-time win list as a head coach at Syracuse. 5 9-plus win seasons in his first 7. Syracuse won the toss and chose to receive, did not choose to defer the option to the second half, and that means you have to kick to Kevin Johnson, Mike.
Well, Kevin Johnson told me yesterday or 2 days ago when we were talking to him in Syracuse, he said, they kicked to me, I'm going to return that opening kickoff for a touchdown. I reminded him. He told me the same thing last year, Ron Franklin and I, when we were doing the Virginia Tech game, he said, they didn't kick the ball to me.
Kent passing him, the kicker set to knock it in the air. We're underway on a very nice night in Raleigh. They kick it to Johnson from the 10. Gets away from the kicker, still on his feet, looking for room, but NC State did a nice job to stop his forward progress at the 33. So the drive will start there, and Donovan McNabb leads the Syracuse offense onto the field. Senior captain Rod Conrad, excellent blocking fullback Kyle McIntosh, one of the solid runners at the tail position. Wide receivers, Johnson is a great pass catcher as well. He scored touchdowns running and passing in each of the last 2 games. Spotwood's a great deep threat. Up front of the offensive line, Corey Bowen returns. He's missed the last couple of games because of a knee injury. He really missed the entire Michigan game, suffering that injury early at the Big House. The Syracuse drive will start from their own 34. First carry, McIntosh. A couple of yards, tackled by Rashad Streets on that NC State defensive line. This is the youngest part of this group. If there's a concern for NC State defensively tonight, it's the defensive line. Bobby Cotton has to play big, good rush guy off the end. Linebacking core is very young. Edrick Smith is a kid who grew up 2 miles from the Alabama campus, got away from Alabama, is playing here at NC State, true freshman starter, and these guys are real good. Perry has 3 interceptions, the secondary 10 interceptions in 3 games this year. No one in the country has more. Second and 8 for the Orange Men. And McNabb to the air. Finds Quinton Spotwood, who picks up a first down at the 47, Lloyd Harrison in on the coverage.
And Mike, that's what makes Donovan McNabb a difficult quarterback to try to rush, because he's such speed getting on the outside, and Syracuse will move the quarterback around, faking the counter play, rolling out. You see him get his feet up under him, get squared, gets the ball to Quentin Spotwood. Number 8 coming from the backside, finding a little hole in the zone, sitting down, getting that completion from Donovan McNabb.
13th catch of the season for Spotwood. Still looking to break a long one. Yet to find the end zone. Syracuse will work now out of the shotgun. And they will move people and formations a lot. About 7 yards to Maurice Jackson, the sophomore out of Rochester, New York, right in front of Tony Scott. Jackson is seeing action in the Syracuse 4 wide receiver sets.
Mike, we talked about Donovan McNabb coming into this ballgame, 51 of 67, 652 yards, 6 touchdowns, no interceptions. His coaches talked about, he said he has only thrown 1 bad pass. So you see his accuracy is much better. The 41st consecutive start.
Marvin Graves, when he was here at Syracuse, started for 4 consecutive years. McNabb erasing some of those marks. Kyle McIntosh squirts across the 40 and gets a first down, but a penalty marker is down in the spot that usually signifies offensive holding. Big East officials working tonight's game in Raleigh. The other way around, it's a face mask, so it will move Syracuse forward.
And John Sophie, the supervisor of the Big East, when I was coaching at Pittsburgh, he was very active and an outstanding referee, and you knew when you had him that the ball game was going to be under control.
15-yard face mask on the defense, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, first down.
Mike O'Kane's team haven't given up many penalty yards this year. This one hurts.
It's number 53, Edric Smith, from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, just 2 miles from the Alabama campus. And Alabama wasn't really recruiting him hard, and North Carolina State stole a good linebacker.
What a time to get his first spot on that start on national TV against number 11 in the nation and an excellent quarterback. McNabb from the 24, first option look. McIntosh. Syracuse will have it first and 10 from the 11. Rodney Redd had to push him out of bounds.
A speed option down the line of scrimmage, and you look for a big play out of your fullback, Rob Conrad. He's 6'3", 250 pounds. The fullback, he's going to get a nice block right here, and then the back, Kyle McIntosh, is going to read that block and get extra yardage. Good job blocking downfield by Darryl Daniel, the wide receiver also.
Conrad leading the way, back in there. Jeff Lowe, bottom of your screen, good blocking receiver. They run the fullback for the first time tonight, and Conrad gets it inside the 10 to about the 8-yard line. Well, this Syracuse offense, Mike, has gotten off to a terrific start. Over 30 points in every game, 33 in the loss to Tennessee, 38 in the win at Michigan, 70 in the home win 10 days ago against Rutgers.
They got all the elements. They got a power runner inside in Conrad. They got a fast tailback in McIntosh. They got a quarterback who can do it all, and they got speed at the wide receivers. They can attack you everywhere in this football field.
Steven Grominski, the tight end, changes sides for 2nd and 7. McNabb looking for Conrad. Rob knocked out at the 3. Just be short of the first down. Jason Perry made the tackle. It'll be 3rd and short.
And Mike, Rob Conrad is the type of fullback, carries the ball up inside on the previous play. Blocked the play before that, now catches the ball. That's why Paul Pasqualoni calls him the most complete football player. He does it all for you out of the backfield.
Had an excellent pass-catching day at Michigan. That was his 12th reception of the year, 11 coming into tonight. 3rd and 2 for Syracuse. McNabb making an adjustment with 5 on the play clock. Out of the wishbone, it is Conrad, left side. That's going to be very close. Probably going to have to measure. Lloyd Harrison, the cornerback out of New York, stuck his nose in there.
What makes it so dangerous down here is Donovan McNabb becomes the extra factor because he runs the ball so well.
Have to bring on the chains to measure.
Relatively easy this first drive for the offensive line of Syracuse.
Roll it over, see if you can stick something in between the nose of the ball and the down marker. That's short. Now let's see, from a momentum standpoint, try to show them if you've got the strength, Syracuse will go for it.
You see how tight the linebackers are for North Carolina State. Now Syracuse eventually feels like they can attack them with the option game because the tightness that they play. They feel like they can get them sealed up inside and get the ball kicked on the outside.
Well, these State fans come to their feet for fourth and inches. They can get a first down if stopped short of a touchdown. McNabb again making an adjustment. Touchdown, Syracuse.
Mike, Donovan McNabb is 6'3", 220 pounds. He bench presses 350 pounds. So when he runs the football, whether it's a quarterback sneak, he's going to get a little push. And a nice job again by the offensive line of Syracuse.
Third rushing touchdown of the season, 14th of McNabb's career. Nate Trout on for the extra point. Kevin Johnson, the starting wide receiver, former high school quarterback, is the holder. Guy with good hands. Trout missed 7 extra points last year. Perfect thus far this season. Donovan McNabb leads a ground-based drive for Syracuse from the Orange.
ESPN's presentation of Thursday Night Football is brought to you by National Car Rental. So what are you waiting for? Let's go. And by Outback Steakhouse. For a legendary steak, fresh fish, or tender chicken, get to Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right.
Well, that Syracuse offense, third in the nation in scoring, moves down the field in workmanlike fashion. McNabb sneaking it in from a yard plus for the touch. Syracuse leads 7-0. Now NC State set to get the ball for the first time. Ray Robinson at the top of your screen, number 5, is a really exciting true freshman you will see a lot of in that NC State backfield. If not this year, then certainly in the future. Out of Hilton Head, South Carolina, has that wiggle and is described as special by the coaches around here with that potential. Eric Leek is also back deep to receive the kickoff from Peter Ferris. Sophomore out of New Jersey. It will be Leek from the 1. Leek made a nice cut. Not many Syracuse players on that side, but Jason Poles, the starting defensive back, makes the tackle. The drive starts short of the 20.
Mike, what Kevin Rogers, the offensive coordinator, does, he scripts the first 15 plays, and you see the different formations that he showed you. I formation 4 times. They broke the eye a little bit with the offset fullback, but they're given different looks, the 4 or 5 different formations in that drive down the field to see how the adjustments are going to be made by North Carolina State's defensive coordinators.
There's Kevin Rogers, the offensive coordinator, who's trying to even deepen the game plan that George DeLeon and the offense got going about a decade ago for Syracuse. Jamie Barnett, the quarterback for NC State, and he is a good one as well. Flushed from the pocket and throws lopsided and 1 foot in the air and incomplete as he was rushed by Ricky Simpkins. Here is the offense for North Carolina State. You got to start with Barnett, who is making his 22nd consecutive start. He is a feisty guy, really talented too. Rashawn Spikes, Connecticut kid who chose Syracuse, NC State at the end and decided Wolfpack. Chris Coleman doesn't get the pub because of Torrey Holt, but he has a 19-plus yard per catch average. And up front, best offensive lineman, we'll say Ian Rafferty, the left tackle, who shut out Andre Wadsworth in the sack column when they played Florida State last year. 3 receivers, no tight end for 2nd and 10. Play clock at 1. Just got it up in time. Nearly completed, Orion Hamrick, the junior wide receiver. It is the 3rd receiver. Ian McIntosh had man coverage for Syracuse. Here's the Orange up front. Mark Pilon was taken number 4 in the draft, the CFL draft of native Canadians. He chose to come back to Syracuse instead of playing for the Calgary Stampeders. Keith Bullock was a safety, was an outside linebacker, now has moved inside to be the quarterback of the Orange defense. And in the secondary, without their best corner, Will Allen, who will see action coming back from an injury, but David Byrd is a speed guy, track guy, skipped football last year, back playing football this year. Both tailbacks, Spikes and Robinson, in the game for 3rd and 10. Barnett thinking about throwing. Incomplete. The NC State folks really want a flag because Jason Poles had his hand on the receiver. They may have a good claim. I think one may have come down very late from the back judge. That's the correct call. It'll be first down, Wolfpack.
Mike, Torrey Holt is going to draw double teams all night. They're going to make sure that they get some help on him. You see the corner running stride for stride with him here. David Burden, he's getting some help.
Eligible pass receiver, 10-yard penalty, automatic first down.
So NC State keeps the drive alive thanks to the Syracuse penalty.
You see Jamie Barnett trying to get the ball to Torrey Holt. Will Allen had him for a little while and then turned him over to the safety.
Some huge numbers, including his last game against Baylor. First down for NC State. Barnett's been pressured a lot and goes down this time. Sacked by Brian Coleman, the right tackle out of the Cleveland area. Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio. Second sack of the season for the senior.
Mike, Brian Coleman saved a possible touchdown for Syracuse because Jamie Barnett didn't have enough time to try to find Torrey Holt. Now, they had him one-on-one with Ian McIntosh, number two, and he just ran by Ian McIntosh. Now, here's on the outside. Torrey Holt just runs away from Ian McIntosh. He's wide open, but there's no way to throw the football.
Syracuse defensive line pressure has been good in the first four snaps. After the loss of seven, second and long. Show some pressure, and Jason Poles, who loves to stick his nose and hit people, knocked Rashawn Spikes off his feet.
Well, Jason Poles was a quarterback in high school. Alabama recruited him. He moved to defense, and you see him right here hit this gap right here and make this tackle. He timed that up perfect, and what's going to have to happen, Jamie Barnett's going to have to change his cadence a little bit because Syracuse already has a little bit of a read on what Barnett's calling and the time he's going to take the football.
Ricky Collins, 19, on the field for the Wolfpack. It's third and long. They need to get to the 37 for a first down. Holt got him there and more. Torrey Holt into Syracuse territory at the 43-yard line. There's that explosiveness. 41 yards on third and long.
Well, George DeLeon, the defensive coordinator of Syracuse, said he can win a game all by himself. He gets inside. He gets a little pick here by the pattern, but he just shows his burst and speed getting away from the defender. Boy, he separates right away from Will Allen. They like him on crossing routes.
That will not hurt his 20-yard per-catch average this year. He gets a breather. Ryan Hammer comes in. Matter of fact, all second-team receivers right now. Miscommunication. Barnett keeps it alive and is able to get back to the original line of scrimmage. Stan Gibbs in on the tackle. We talk about the numbers of Torrey Holt. Just look at what he's done the first three games. The Ohio game, it could not have been more wet here in Raleigh that night than those numbers against the great DBs at Florida State. They're great athletes. And the numbers against Baylor, the single game record at NC State.
And Mike, you know George DeLeon very well. He used to be the offensive coordinator of Syracuse. They had a lot of great receivers at Syracuse. And he said about Torrey Holt, he has more influence on the game than any other receiver that I've seen. And that takes into account a lot of good Syracuse receivers.
Barnett looking Holt's way. Rushed again, lucky to get away to Spikes, who's got room. Rashawn Spikes with a burst. Inside the 10, first and goal, Wolfpack. Donald Dinkins nearly had a sack, but Barnett shows a little Donovan McNabb elusiveness.
Well, Jamie Barnett, he won that football game last year when North Carolina State went into Syracuse. He said, I gained a lot of confidence by taking my team for a win over Donovan McNabb's team. Shows you a little Donovan McNabb move right here. Strength, Donald Dinkins had a hand on him. Rashawn Spikes with a nice reception and then turned it into a very nice play.
Quite a throw as well. Wow. By Barnett. A timeout here halfway through the first quarter. Before first and goal, one of the Syracuse players is shaken up. It's Duke Pettijohn. one of their defensive linemen taking a knee on the field. We'll take a moment. Holt, Barnett, and the Pack threatening. Syracuse leads 7-0, but NC State in the red zone at the 6. And first and goal. They've hit pass plays of 41 and 36 yards on this drive. And remember, the third down defensive holding that kept the drive alive. Three receivers, one back for the Wolfpack. Barnett adjusting. 2 seconds on the clock. Just gets it off. No, he did not get the playoff, and it will be delay of game. Not the penalty you want to get coming out of a timeout.
Dead ball. Delay of game. On the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat the down.
He saw something, didn't he?
Yeah, what happens, Mike, you have a play called, and all of a sudden you want to check to a fade because he saw bump and run coverage all along his wide receivers, and he wanted to try to get Torrey Holt on the bump and run situation on the fade against Ian McIntosh. But it took too long. Play took too long getting into him, and it took too long for him to try to get beat the clock.
Holt has a 4-inch height advantage on McIntosh, and that's what's happening up at the top of your screen again. Eric Leek down on the bottom.
He'll get some help from the safety, Phil Nash.
The option pitch to Spikes. Now, rarely do we chart hang time on option pitches, but you did there. Phil Nash the stop after a 3-yard pickup.
Well, it's interesting. When we were talking to the defensive coaches at Syracuse about Jamie Barnett, they talked about him wearing a knee brace. I asked him about the option play, and he said, well, it's very clear in tape that we see the knee brace on his knee, so we're not sure how much option they will run. But obviously, by the knee brace, they know he's not the threat that the tailback will be. There you see the brace.
Injured the knee playing pickup football this summer, but was able to be back for most of spring practice. Ryan Hamrick, the receiver at the top of the screen. A little more option with Spikes into the end zone. Touchdown, State. First touchdown of the year for Rashawn Spikes. And NC State on for the extra point. Denny Deskevich. First time kicking. They've had tons of problems with the placements.
Not sure he even has his name on his jersey yet.
Well, if he keeps doing that, he'll get it. They'll sew it maybe at halftime. There's a marker down, as you saw. May have been Syracuse peeking in too quick.
Dead ball. False start. Penalty, retry.
Dr. Jerry Punch.
Guys, this kicker here is a walk-on, and they have a rule here at NC State. Michael Kane said, if you're a walk-on and you're a senior, you automatically get to dress. And they dressed this young man last week. We were impressed with him during the pregame warm-ups, and tonight, for the first time, he is in the football game.
He looked pretty good pregame warm-ups tonight as well, Doc. He was making field goals from about 40. They've had injury and production problems with the extra points. Deskevich gets them both, and one counts. We're tied at 7. Who's pitching tonight? Smoltz, Glavin? Doesn't matter. You're not going to see offense over there. We got offense over here from Raleigh. We don't know where Vanna White is, but Mike, Jerry, and I will chip in. We're going to buy vowels, whatever letters we need to get Danny Deskevich his name and his jersey tonight. The 143-pound place kicker, walk-on, added the extra point. We're tied at 7.
There's a student trainer on their way to Kmart right now to get those letters.
Passing him, kicks it off, and it's Kevin Johnson from the 5. Nearly lost the ball as he took a hit. Down to the 30, Anthony Kaysen on the tackle. Let's go back to the key moments of that last drive.
Well, the big play, the holding call, this was the second big play. Torrey Holt, the outside receiver on an inside move, a crossing route, gets that ball right in stride, see the burst, gets into the secondary. Now the yards after catch become very important for Torrey Holt, set him up for that score.
Holt caught a 41-yarder. Rashawn Spikes had a 36-yard catch, then the rushing touchdown to tie it at 7. Syracuse offense takes the field. Just one wide receiver in for first and 10. Drive starts from the 30. Ian McIntosh. I beg your pardon, Kyle McIntosh. His brother Ian plays on the defensive secondary and got beat by Holt a lot on that first drive. Here again, Jerry.
After the Syracuse initial offensive drive and score, Jeff Snipes, the NC State co-defensive coordinator, talked to his young defense, said, guys, we're going to make some adjustments. We're no longer going to bring our linebackers up inside of that compressed 4-3 set. We're going to let them back away a little bit. We're getting hurt on the perimeter. So the guys will be back off the line of scrimmage about a yard or so. By the way, on the initial drive, there were two major missed assignments at defensive end and linebacker that allowed some long gainers for Syracuse. Mental mistakes.
Jerry Kent Bridge is the other co-defensive coordinator. McNabb looks for his second option. Intercepted. Tony Scott picks off McNabb for the first time this year, and Scott has running room. Brought down at the 32. 11 interceptions this year for the NC State Wolfpack DBs. They lead the nation.
This North Carolina State defensive backfield dropped a lot of interception opportunities last year. Tony Scott said he worked hard on catching the football like a receiver. He dropped back, read the eyes of Donovan McNabb, picked this pass off, and sets this North Carolina State in pretty good field position. See him fade right back. He read that route, made that interception. Donovan McNabb made the tackle.
Darryl Daniel not coming back to the ball. There you see the Wolfpack DBs, the Rough Riders, they call themselves. Barnett out of the gun. Torrey Holt, dangerous on this play. Brought down at the 27-yard line. Moreland Greenwood, the linebacker, made the stop.
Well, there's more pro scouts here tonight than I've seen on the Thursday night ball games. And most of them are here to see Torrey Holt and Donovan McNabb. 16 of them were in a little room today watching the film on Torrey Holt. And they're seeing him live and up close here tonight because he's a great target. And, Mike, we met him the other day. He's got the longest hands. I mean, he's got meat hooks to catch that football.
Size 10 gloves he wears. Remember that when you're shopping this holiday season for the Isotoners. Syracuse offside. Free play for the offense. Spikes gets to the 25, but they'll pick up the first down on the offside. That'll be the second first down picked up via penalty. Well, the great baseball playoffs continue tomorrow on ESPN. What a great day of Frawl Friday at Fenway in the playoffs. Indians Red Sox coverage begins with baseball tonight at 3:30 Eastern with Carl and Peter and Al Leiter. That'll be on ESPN. And then on NBC, it will be the Yankees and the Rangers. Yankees looking for the sweep. As for the afternoon game, Mo Vaughn, who had the big offensive numbers in game one, shut down in game two. Charles Nagy tries to shut him down in game three. Of course, all of the playoff games on ESPN Radio. First and 10 after the penalty. Wolfpack driving. Barnett looking in zone. Overthrew him by about a yard.
But Jamie Barnett liked to have this throw back. Corner route to Torrey Holt. Jason Pose has to defend against him, the inside safety. Now they move Torrey Holt around a lot. Now they've got him lined up against the safety. The safety's going to come from behind, but he's wide open, just overthrew it. Like to have that one back. There's Jason Pose trying to catch up to him.
He had no prayer getting over there.
No, none. That was the right throw by Jamie Barnett, just didn't get it in there.
Eric Leek is at the top of the screen for second and 10. Bring it to Spikes. Keith Bullock, the middle linebacker, who's second on tackling the Syracuse team, got him, but NC State now controlling that line of scrimmage.
That was a nice tackle by Keith Bullock, and the whole scheme of Syracuse is to free the middle linebacker up. He came into this game with 30 tackles. Last year was an outside linebacker.
That other player without his jersey on is Terrence Holt, Torrey Holt's brother. Terrence, and another man with no name, a true freshman here. He and his brother are roommates, and Torrey Holt had a decision, stay or go. And in consulting with his dad, his father, you see in the stands there, and other people around, he decided to stay. And part of the reason for staying was the chance to be with his brother and the chance to move up in the NFL draft. As we said, timeout. NC State will step out with them. Tie game. Wolfpack looking to take the lead. Well, during the timeout, when there was a mistake made in terms of personnel on the field, Torrey Holt got right in the face of Ray Robinson, the freshman running back, in a friendly way. So we can't make those kind of mistakes on our field in this kind of game. He's not only a leader in stats, he's a leader in all the intangibles for this team. He's in motion on third and six. Barnett couldn't find Holt. Now fires for him. He's got it at the 1 yard line. First and goal. A tremendous catch by Torrey Holt.
Well, the pro guys are going to like this play on Torrey Holt because he was covered and he ran an inside route. He adjusts this route, goes in motion, so to give him a free release down the field. Now he works inside, but he's not open. Now look at him. Slides backwards, gets his hands up against Charles Burton, the defensive back, makes that play.
And his brother Terrence.
Wow. That was a nice adjustment by a good wide receiver. This is a Torrey Holt show. I can see now why George DeLeon, the defensive coordinator, said he can win a ball game by himself.
Holt out, two tight ends in, first and goal. Barnett keeps it. Swooped by Keith Bullock. Syracuse's 6'4" junior middle linebacker snuffed that out.
Yeah, Jamie Barnett just doesn't look nifty on that knee. He wanted to pitch that football, but they took away the pitch. And Keith Bullock, the middle linebacker, shuffled down the line of scrimmage and makes a tough hit on the quarterback, Jamie Barnett. Wanted to pitch that football. Now here's Bullock lighting up the quarterback.
Former safety, outside backer last year. You see that knee brace. Again, late getting the play, and there's five on the play clock for second and goal.
It's a fade all the way here, probably.
There is the fade for Holt on McIntosh. And giving away 4 inches, the junior cornerback hung with Torrey Holt that time.
But they know when you see North Carolina State getting split backs that they're probably not going to run the football, and the fade is the obvious pass. Torrey Holt against Ian McIntosh, 5'10", plays him very well.
Mike, is it tougher to throw that fade to the wide side?
You want a lot of room to throw right. That football. You want to lead the receiver over his shoulder near the out-of-bounds mark, away from the defender.
Three in the backfield, Holt on the bench. Third and goal. Barnett option again. Squirts forward and scores. Touchdown.
Play again. They may take the pitch away. A low block. It looked like he fell down a little short of the goal line, but they gave him a touchdown. But Sean Spikes with a nice block. Michael King says it was surely a TD.
It's where the ball is when the knee touches, and that's why you question it. But he was close enough. Here is Deskevich earning a letter with each kick. We've got him to DES, and you know what? We're going to have a chance to go through the rest of the alphabet, I got the feeling. Well, NC State knows how to play with ranked teams. Up in Syracuse last year against Florida State, they put up a lot of points last year. The game here against Florida State, they fell behind 7-0 in that game on the very first play, not the first drive like Syracuse did. And this team didn't get flustered. They didn't get uptight. They take a lot of it from their head coach. And what they did, they came back and shut Florida State out for every play after the first one. And not many teams can say they've done that.
No, and in that ball game, and we were talking to Torrey Holt, the wide receiver, the other day. And there was a bulletin board copy of a picture that Florida State didn't have a lot of respect for him. And he caught the touchdown pass. And he said he told the defensive back, why'd you let me get behind you? He said he just felt like you're doing a little talking to Florida State. And he said now they'll have a little bit more respect for me and our ball club. So this ball club is just trying to gain respect against the best teams in the country.
And one of the reasons they're doing it, that great receiver, Torrey Holt, his papa, standing by with Dr. Jerry Punch.
I am with Odell, and Odell, you have got to be so proud of Torrey Holt. Every week, he just he shocks you. You were telling me a moment ago.
Yeah, he does. Every week, it looks like he's getting better and better, and he's working it. And he's got a good work habit, and we like what he's doing right now to try to get himself to the next level.
I started to ask you where he got those big hands, but I see your huge paws down there. We'll talk more after the kickoff about the young man who is a great, great football player. Guys?
All right, Jerry. Passing him back on to kick is Holt and Barnett. Put their team in front. 14-7 NC State. Kevin Johnson waiting for the kickoff, and he gets it at the 10. Johnson hits the hole quick. He's taken down at the 30. Let's go back to Jerry.
Odell, Torrey lost his mother and your wife just after Christmas in 1996, and he said her memory has been an inspiration to the entire family and maybe what kept him in school. Did that help him stay in school to help younger brother Terrence?
Yeah, I think it did. He grew up a lot during that time. He was here by himself, and he had a lot of time to reflect on what his mother meant to him, and he come out to dedicate it this season to him and last season to him, and he's doing a fantastic job. Yeah, we're very proud of Torrey and the accomplishments he's making now in this conference here.
You should be very proud. We watch the Syracuse on offense, guys.
Jerry, thank you. D. Brown, the second string tailback in for the Orange. He gets 7 yards. It'll be second and 3. Jason Perry, the free safety, in on that tackle. Well, Torrey Holt's name is becoming more well-known because of the big wins that this program has pulled off. Maybe you don't know what he's done career-wise here. This is a school that's turned out, hey, with Jeffries, Eddie Coyne, great receivers. So these stats are passing real legit players. Third in receptions, third in receiving yards, the school record, 24 touchdowns. Catches. After the pickup of 7, second and 3, Conrad's the lone back. And he gets the first down across the 40 to the 41. We've seen two very simple things, and you're the coach, so back me up here. NC State can throw it on Syracuse. Syracuse can run it up the middle on NC State.
Yeah, I was just thinking the same thing, Mike, as you were starting that sentence, that they're having relatively easy time with the offensive line up inside. On that last formation, they go to two tight ends, and they're just trying to pound the football at this North Carolina State defense. Now they're going to get in the wishbone.
Three backs, they do a lot out of this. They even run the option with some of their wide receivers. They start with the fullback up the middle, and Conrad gets it to the 47, picking up 5 yards.
That seems to be their game plan here in the first quarter. Run inside. They've run inside with Conrad, Kyle McIntosh, D. Brown. And what that'll do, Mike, eventually soften up for the option on the outside, and then eventually the option pass.
Is it tough to be patient when you're calling plays and you're trailing 14-7?
No, I think they score so many points. The 7 points means nothing to them.
We see the numbers. Syracuse on the ground, State in the air. Should be final snap of quarter number one. D. Brown gets it out to midfield. That'll be a yard or so short of the first down. It'll be third and short when we start the second quarter. Quite a quarter for NC State. McNabb's first interception of the year helps set up a touchdown. Puts NC State on top. And Torrey Holt already 65 yards receiving after 15 minutes. This big one helped keep the opening touchdown drive alive after one. The Wolfpack 14, the Orange 7 on Thursday Night Football. The second quarter from Raleigh, North Carolina with Dr. Jerry Punch and Mike Gottfried, Mike Tirico. Ball Pasqualoni's Orangemen trailing by 7. Torrey Holt, a big factor on offense, 65 receiving yards in the first quarter. Syracuse offense faces a 3rd and 2 from midfield. McNabb runs option with Kyle McIntosh, who picks up the first down. Got a nice block from Kevin Johnson, but a penalty marker comes in late as McIntosh was knocked down at the 43. Maybe the block was too nice by McIntosh or by Johnson.
Two big penalties against the Syracuse Orangemen. One by the defense and a holding that kept a drive open alive, and this one here taking away a first down.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat 3rd down.
Well, Mike, you called it. Kevin Johnson, the wide receiver, blocking downfield against Lloyd Harrison. Got him. He got his hands out there, and that's the call. They're still in the good shape here. Third, seven, third, and eight.
The penalty from the spot of the foul. They have to get to the North Carolina State 48 for the first down. We'll see if they go to Johnson, the receiver, to atone for the blocking mistake. McNabb moving out of the pocket. Looking deep for Johnson. Incomplete. The NC State DBs did a great job, and that's when it's toughest to cover the Syracuse receivers, that fourth and fifth second.
Well, you put an asterisk by that because they couldn't get the first down. They've got him doubled right here. Marcel Huff, number 21 on Kevin Johnson, with help from Jason Perry.
The Rough Riders making their presence felt. Torrey Hope back deep to receive. He's taken one back for a touchdown. That 19.5 average is sixth in the nation. Doug Duncan is the Syracuse punter. Averages 43 per. This high kick that Holt calls for a fair catch. Dropped it at the 15, but got it back before Jason Poles was able to fall on it. Scary moment for NC State. 41-yard kick with good hang time from Duncan.
Little indecision here whether or not to make the fair catch. You see him take the eye off the ball. He wasn't sure. He wasn't sure whether he wanted to fair catch this ball, and then he makes the fair catch call and takes his eye off the football.
Well, you can see it on that replay for sure. So NC State dodges a potential mistake, and they'll start the drive at their own 15. They started to drive at their own 16 and scored first time they touched the ball. David Byrd, the speedster, responsibility for Torrey Holt in the secondary. Barnett to the air. Overthrows Eric Leak, the sophomore receiver. It'll be second down. A college game day. Chris Lee and Kirk after tonight head to Columbus, Ohio, the old horseshoe on the banks of the Olentangy, to get ready for that Ohio State-Penn State game that you'll see on ABC. Meantime, at noon on ESPN, we'll have Wisconsin-Indiana on the deuce, Kentucky-Arkansas, and another really good one, maybe the best one of the day in the SEC, Georgia-LSU. Mike, Ron, and Adrian will have that in primetime here on ESPN. Pretty good college football Saturday. As you look at Donovan McNabb from Big Ten country, Illinois guy. But now it's Jamie Barnett's stage. In-state star from Roxboro, North Carolina. Second and 10, pass knocked down by Jason Poles once again.
Mike, Jamie Barnett started his junior year in high school as a wide receiver and a defensive back. He intercepted 8 passes, and then he became the quarterback his senior year in high school and threw 25 touchdown passes in the run-and-shoot offense. His coach, Mike O'Kane, says he just wins. And you talked about the good quarterbacks in the ACC. Mike O'Kane said, I wouldn't trade Jamie Barnett.
You go all the way around. You have Cooklick at Wake Forest, Virginia with Brooks. There are good quarterbacks all over this league. Joe Hamilton at Georgia Tech, you saw in primetime last Saturday. Hit late and throws and incomplete. They say Ricky Collins, first time he's seen the football field in his career, had it bounce on the ground before he juggled it. Now NC State will have to kick it away.
Put a lot of pressure on Jamie Barnett. Number 70, Donald Dinkins again arriving. Phil Nash on coverage against Ricky Collins. Ian McIntosh also there. Now Quentin Spotwood becomes a factor here. Punt returners had a lot of success at Syracuse.
Jesse Wade is into punt. Syracuse thought they could get one. They ran into Wade, but he didn't go down. They came up just shy of him, and fair caught by Spotwood at the 45. If Wade was a little more experienced, he might have been able to get it running into the kicker. Syracuse takes over in NC State territory when you come back to Raleigh.
ESPN's presentation of Thursday Night Football is brought to you by the new Dodge, It's About Change, and by Frost Brewed Coors Light, who reminds you the three most important words are, hey, beer man.
We are in the state capitol in Raleigh, North Carolina. What a beautiful city this is, the NC State campus. Raleigh was voted the second best big southern city place to live in Money Magazine in June of 98. Mike brings his Money Magazine copies on the road for the Thursday night.
Oh, you're big with all the Chamber of Commerce, aren't you?
That's right.
Take got a letter from San Diego.
Looking forward to
every week.
First and 10 from the 45. A little reverse to the receiver, Maurice Jackson, who has excellent speed. Jackson has a lot of room. Maurice Jackson inside the 15 to the 10-yard line. Jason Perry helped save a touchdown. They gained 35 on the reverse, but there is a flag down back at the Syracuse bench area. It is behind the line of scrimmage by 4 yards. I've never seen a face mask penalty thrown behind the line of scrimmage.
No,
they don't play like that.
Foul. Face mask on the defense, half the distance of the goal, first down.
Well, you're so conscious of Donovan McNabb. As soon as he moves in one direction, that's why the reverse works so well here, because everybody's trapped inside because they're playing Donovan McNabb. Maurice Jackson comes around the reverse, picks up some nice block, but you're right, Jason Perry with a nice job. Maurice Jackson showing his speed. Jason Perry showing his speed, catching him.
4-3-40. Syracuse's fastest receiver. They move it to the 5 with the penalty. First and goal for Syracuse. They've been very good in the red zone this year. McNabb with Conrad. Pitches late. Conrad nearly lost it out of bounds, and the penalty marker goes down. Lloyd Harrison was over there, the DB, pushing him out.
Good job in the secondary by Lloyd Harrison. Jason Perry again taking the pitch man and the quarterback.
And pick up the flag. So there'll be no infraction.
Mike, they had so much success inside. Now you'd think maybe they'd run inside on this play here. They're having so much success in a tackle play. Tackle to tackle. You see the good job by the secondary coming up here in great position right here to stop the option.
Perry and Harrison and Red, they are really good. 11 interceptions, a veteran bunch back there. Second and goal. They go inside with D. Brown for a few yards, and D. Brown fighting for extra yardage against NC State brings to mind the play that Jerry showed you earlier tonight when Syracuse was trying to get the winning touchdown against North Carolina State last year at the end of regulation. It was Brown, then a freshman, trying to get the ball over the goal line for the touchdown. NC State knocked it away, forced overtime, and won when Pasqualoni desperately tried to call timeout. But NC State went for two and got the win.
And D. Brown says it was very emotional. He felt like he left his teammates down, but he said, I think about that play every time my number's called.
And you see Syracuse's red zone success. Kevin Johnson in motion. McNabb will roll, look for the tight end, and incomplete. Spotwood and Conrad, actually, in the same spot.
I think he was trying to throw the ball to Conrad. Rob Conrad, but Spotwood came in front of Rob Conrad to try to make that catch.
Syracuse will have to try a field goal.
Here's Quentin Spotwood working across the field. He thinks the pass is to him. Rob Conrad standing behind him. He thinks the pass is coming to him.
Wind is picking up a little bit. Kicking is going to be more of a problem as this night goes on. Nate Trout, 11 of 15 on field goals. His first 2 years, 5 of 7 this year. An extra point size field goal puts 3 on the board. Syracuse got inside the red zone, but NC State's defense over the 3. The Wolfpack lead on 4. On Saturday night, good one in primetime on Thursday night football. The NC State lead is 4 after a Syracuse field goal drive. The big play on that drive was the reverse to Maurice Jackson. So McNabb atones for the interception earlier. 4 drives, a touchdown, a field goal, an interception, and they were forced to punt. Ray Robinson, number 5, near side, Eric Leek. Opposite him is Peter Ferris, gets set to kick off. Kick They kick to Leak again, and he'll take it from the one. Well covered by Syracuse. The drive will start from the 23, a 21-yard return.
Torrey Holt has had a big first half. Crossing route early in the ball game. He gets away from Ian McIntosh. Set up the first score, Mike, because the yards after the catch. The quick screen inside shows you his burst down the field. And the third play is the adjustment. He's open, gets his hand up, moves to the open area, catches the ball.
3 for 65, the stats on Holt through one.
And they better find a way to double cover Torrey Holt.
Barnett back to the air, looking long for Holt. Incomplete. Holt had made the adjustment to the route, but Ian McIntosh would not let anyone behind him. Back to Jerry Punch again.
For those who want to follow Torrey Holt's progress and can't get to an NC State football game, he has his own website now. It is basically Torrey Holt's www.ncsu.edu/makinghistory-Torrey. Bio, stats, basically background, game-by-game information, and archives of pictures, everything you wanted to know about Torrey Holt's hunt for the Heisman from NC State University. How about that, guys? His own website.
Doc, you sound like Ross Perot last night when he was giving that out.
On second and 10, Rashawn Spikes gets to the 29. It will be third and 3. The guy does 2 games a week and still has time to keep up on the latest current events. An impressive man, this Gottfried.
I enjoyed Ross Perot last night, and I'm going to send him a card.
Well, Heisman and the Torrey Holt story is one that, if Holt continues what he's done in the first quarter for this game, you can legitimately talk about him as being the best receiver. Does try to throw him into that category because he's more than just stats and numbers. We talk about him dominating a game. 3rd and 2. Barnett. Oh, he did a nice job to get the first down. Stan Gibbs had the shot to get him and stop the first down from happening, but Brian Coleman had to make the play. 1st and 10, Wolfpack.
And a big first down by Jamie Barnett. Everything's covered. Syracuse gets a little pressure in the backfield. Missed tackle by Ricky Simpkins. Just got a hand on him. There's another miss by Stan Gibbs. And finally, Brian Coleman brings him down. The beauty of this is that they're keeping Syracuse's offense off the field.
They've picked up 4 of 5 third downs, but they're not really making an impact on first down. They've been making lots of plays on 2nd and long and 3rd and long. And Barnett tries to beat the clock and does, using the 2nd NC State timeout of this first half. Plenty of time left. First half, State by 4. One timeout remaining for the Wolfpack here in the first half. Holt and the offense facing a 1st and 10. Well, they were so excited after the Florida State win, and they are anticipating another great night here in Raleigh. Barnett hit as he throws, but finds Holt. McIntosh fell down, and Holt picks up the first down across midfield to the Syracuse 42.
Mike, Syracuse is letting Torrey Holt get off the line of scrimmage. When they move him inside, there's nobody bumping him, nobody trying to knock him out of his route. Gets a free release down the field. So there's nobody. There's no one right here to knock him off his route. Breaks outside, wide open, makes the catch. Ian McIntosh falls. They've got to get some pressure. They've got to at least try to slow him down on his release.
That catch good for 22. 1st and 10, they run with Rashawn Spikes. Keith Bullock pulls him down.
Rashawn Spikes played in Connecticut. He was only the 2nd athlete in Connecticut history to be named All-State 3 times. Played for Bob Semizik, an outstanding high school coach.
Spikes from Meriden, Connecticut. And I mentioned earlier, it came down to North Carolina State and Syracuse for Spikes. The McIntosh brothers, Ian on defense number 2 and Kyle on offense for Syracuse, are Connecticut kids, and Syracuse has had a lot of success in that state. Spikes came down to NC State. The starting man in the backfield with Barnett takes the pitch on 2nd down. Shoved out of bounds hard on the sidelines.
North Carolina State pulled Todd Boyle, the tackle. Keith Bullock, the middle linebacker, is going to scrape. Now he reads it. Makes the hit on Rashawn Spikes.
Syracuse does that defensively with that middle linebacker, tries to keep him free and make a bunch of tackles.
Mike, he runs from sideline to sideline. He's got to make plays for him. And he has made plays, 30 tackles coming into this ballgame.
That's why having an old safety in that spot helps them from a speed standpoint. Third and three. Beat the clock. That play did not look to be smooth and error-free.
No, I don't know what that play was. That just busted. I'm not sure Jamie Barnett knew the play. He's talking to Rashawn Spikes there like that was completely a bust.
They're going to go here on fourth and three, I think, because of their shaky kicking game.
Well, you better know if you're Syracuse where Torrey Holt is. And Chris Coleman on the other side, number 84, is a very good receiver. They're going to use their last timeout.
So NC State out of timeouts with 9:08 left, second quarter. Store that one away. The Wolfpack lead by four, trying to keep a drive alive. As you come back, the fans rise to their feet here at Carter-Finley Stadium. It's fourth and three, and the Wolfpack will go for it. They're on the option, and Barnett has a lot of room. First down and much more to the 14-yard line. Alex Rice threw a great block.
They gave Syracuse a little dose of their own medicine, the option play. On fourth and short, Jamie Barnett going to take the ball, option with Rashawn Spikes. Gets a good seal block. There's nothing coming from the inside. They've got everything sealed. 55, Todd Boyle with a good block.
Rice inside, Boyle the seal block Mike just showed you. 21 yards, the drive's alive. On first and 10. Barnett to the air. Touchdown, Ryan Hamlin. Just the second catch of the year for Hamrick, who holds on the field goals and extra points. Deskevich, the walk-on. Sneaks it in. The Wolfpack by 11.
Brian Hamrick is going to go in motion. It sets, what it does is it sets him man for man against this defender, McIntosh, for the corner route. Gives him a little bit more field to break to the corner. Jamie Barnett with a good throw. Just work him inside. Now gets him head up, stems him, and then breaks to the outside. Ian McIntosh just too much cushion. Jamie Barnett throwing off his back foot, just getting the ball to Ryan Hamrick.
This is the first year that Hamrick has been playing here at NC State. One of those great stories, former walk-on, the man who caught the touchdown from Barnett. Look at Barnett's total numbers, very similar to last year. His stats better than Donovan McNabb to this point.
Mike, he talked about that, and Jared Punch mentioned it early, that the win over Syracuse and Donovan McNabb gave him a lot of confidence to lead his football team.
Well, Paul Pasqualoni in Syracuse knew this NC State team was good. Didn't build up the revenge part from last year's game, from what they told us. And you kind of sense that it now has to be seeping into their heads. Hey, these guys did this to us last year. Is the same thing happening again?
It's the reversal, Mike. They've jumped on Syracuse right now. Syracuse strong enough to come back in this football game.
Syracuse jumped out to a 14-0 lead in last year's game. The starting tailback, McIntosh, down the sidelines. He's ridden out of bounds at
the 36 by Jason Perry. Now the National Football League in primetime on ABC and ESPN. Good ones this week. Sunday night, Warren Moon and the Seahawks to Arrowhead, where it's bright and loud, just like here, to take on the Kansas City Chiefs. Game time after primetime. Then ABC's Monday Night Football to Green Bay, Wisconsin. Brett Favre and the Packers against Randall Cunningham and the Vikings. Pair of 4-0 teams on Monday Night Football at 8 Eastern. We start it with Monday Night Countdown on ESPN at 6:30 Eastern.
And, Mike, you were talking about Warren Moon. A couple pro scouts said he was exactly the same size as Donovan McNabb, look-alike coming out of college. So they compared him to Warren Moon before the ball game.
Warren at Washington nearly two decades ago. And still going strong in the league. On first down, Syracuse runs some option. McNabb keeps it and gets out of bounds at the 41. Here again, Jared.
You talked about all the pro scouts that are here, and they are all over the stadium during warm-ups tonight. I talked to Bill Polian, president of the Indianapolis Colts. He said, Doc, they should call this game the Talent Bowl tonight. Incredible talent. Talking about, there's Rob Conrad. He said, that young man can do it all. He can block downfield for someone his size. He carries a load down and gets on linebackers and defensive backs. He talked about McNabb, what a great quarterback he was. And he said, you know, Torrey Holt, said he reminds me a little bit of the bookends they had in Miami years ago in Duper and Clayton. Holt can do it all. And McNabb, he said, I don't know who to compare him to. He is just one of the all-time best to come out in a while.
A lot of talent in this field, Jerry. McNabb plays beat the clock and gets the timeout as Syracuse has the same problems NC State had earlier. The Orange, two timeouts remaining. The Wolfpack out. McNabb talking to Stephen Brominski, the tight end. Well, we talked about it earlier when Syracuse jumped out to the 14-0 lead. It was August 30th last year. Syracuse on the prior Sunday won the kickoff classic, shutting out Wisconsin. But after scoring a touchdown in overtime to take a 31-24 lead, NC State runs it in to get within one. Pasqualoni tries to get a timeout. Mike O'Kane decides to go for two. Barnett to Holt. Ball game in the Dome, and NC State shocked Syracuse 32-31. To refresh your memory of how that game transpired, we mentioned the 14-0 lead. The other significant part of that game, Mike, that I remember was 24-24 at the end of regulation, but Syracuse had it with the chance to go in. We talked about the Dee Brown fumble that sent it to overtime.
Well, and you, Syracuse players, I read a lot of different things this week. Kyle McIntosh said the only thing I can remember is them running up and down the sideline talking about North Carolina State, but they haven't come out that way in this first half. But believe me, and you know, you've seen enough Syracuse football film, 11 points. Don't bury the Syracuse football team yet because they're very much alive. They're very capable of coming right back in this ballgame and taking the lead.
After the timeout, it is second and five. More option with McIntosh. Has some room to run this time across midfield. And he picks up a first down at the NC State 47.
And they've had so much success running, Mike, that you haven't seen the other weapons. Kevin Johnson on the outside, Quentin Spotwood, the wide receivers. They're dangerous football players when they get the ball in their hands. And they haven't been a factor here in the first half. It's been Conrad, McIntosh, Dee Brown, Donovan McNabb on the option. The next part of the game that will come is Kevin Johnson, Quentin Spotwood in the passing game.
Spotwood has one catch for 11 yards. Johnson has no catches. On first and 10, it is McIntosh again. Gets to the 40. Nearly had the ball ripped out from him. Marcel Huff was trying to force the turnover.
And you get 7-8 yards a clip when you're running the football. You just have to remain patient.
Syracuse has already run, Mike, for 122 yards on 18 runs, and their running back coach is David Walker. David is fourth on the all-time Syracuse rushing list. And that says a lot when you talk about the backs who've come through this school. James Mungro, a freshman, in the backfield, replacing McIntosh. Mungro went the long way. And Clayton White made him pay for it.
And James Mungro, you're right, is a freshman. His first time he carried the football, he ran 12 yards for a touchdown against Michigan, but it was called back. goes the wrong way on this play. And he's way out of position because Donovan McNabb's going to pitch that ball. Clayton White on the play, and another mistake by Syracuse in a key situation.
Mundrow gained over 8,000 yards in his high school career. Looked very good when he got his hands on the ball in the Rutgers and Michigan games. And chatting with David Walker as D. Brown comes in the backfield now. As Syracuse made nearly half their third downs coming into tonight. They're struggling now. McNabb in trouble and brought down. Corey Smith got the sack, the redshirt freshman's first of his college career.
Good coverage by North Carolina State, but really Donovan McNabb just doesn't get any chance to set up. Corey Smith with the tackle, number 48.
Torrey Hope lets Doug Duncan's pick rest, and the state drive will start at the 12. 40-yard kick with no return. Well, McNabb and the Syracuse offense coming in the best unit statistically and talent-wise was facing the NC State defense, which talent statistic-wise was the poorest unit in this game, and NC State's getting the better of it right now.
Not taking advantage of the opportunities. Too many mistakes. The freshman Mundrow goes into the ball game in a key situation and goes the wrong way. Penalties at the inopportune time.
So this offense that is well over 400 yards on average, a buck 36 in the first 25 minutes. Ray Robinson, the freshman back for NC State, gets it out to the 15-yard line. North Carolina State beat Ohio in its opener, which was a Thursday night game. In an absolute monsoon, they needed a block punt in the fourth quarter and barely beat the run-happy Ohio U team 34-31. Then the win over Florida State 24-7. Then they go to Baylor, and Mike O'Kane's team fell in a huge hole, 26-0, had a great second-half comeback, really had chances to win the game, but they lost 33-30. That's why they sit at 2-1. Barnett to the air on second down, in the air, and incomplete. As the tip drill was on, and Coles and Eric Leek were going after it, but it falls incomplete.
And they talked about that Baylor game. Michael Kane talked about it. He gave credit to Baylor. He just said we weren't ready to play, but gave credit to Baylor for the win. Torrey Holt just falls down here. He's the intended target. Ball gets tipped. Almost an interception by Syracuse. Big third down play here. Syracuse must stop North Carolina State. Get that ball back to 4:58 on the clock.
And third is short or medium or long. NC State has gotten the job done tonight. Have to get to the 23 here. Phil Nash blitz. Barnett beat it. And a lot of room to run. First down for NC State. Barnett looks to be shaken up.
An elusive quarterback. 4-8-40. Running. Everyone recruited him as a defensive back or a wide receiver. NC State said they'd give him a chance at quarterback. He makes the Syracuse defense pay. Charles Burton finally makes the tackle.
19-yard pickup for Barnett, whose elusiveness has been obvious in the early going. The handoff to Robinson, the true freshman. Just short of a first down. Here again, Jerry.
We told you that Jamie Barnett hurt his left knee in a pickup football game back in June. Now, Dr. David Fagenbaum had told Barnett that I could go in and do some things surgically to that knee, but you might miss the entire year. We can rehab the knee, you can wear a brace, and you might be back in 6 months. Fagenbaum told me remarkably in 6 weeks, Barnett was back and ready to practice, and they are absolutely amazed at his mobility with that brace on and that left knee. And that looks like it hasn't slowed him down very much tonight.
He may not like running the option, but he runs in open space pretty well. His parents, Barbara and Chester Barnett, he told us, Mike, one of the reasons he picked NC State was, as you were mentioning, the position opportunities, and he wanted to be near home.
He wanted to stay close to home, and he said the North Carolina State coaches told him he'll get every opportunity to play the quarterback position.
Has a three-year-old son, Jashawn, who's at home watching Dad tonight.
Play stopped as a paper airplane came on the field. I haven't seen paper airplanes in a while. Kind of something you don't see every once in a while, Mike. I don't know.
Hey, you haven't been hanging out in the right places.
No, I haven't.
It's hard to throw them in that studio up there.
Just been seeing a lot of real airplanes.
This Ray Robinson's an impressive running back.
True freshman at Hilton Head, South Carolina. Two touchdowns this year. Syracuse was offside. They pick up the first down by ground, but they'll do it by flag to get more yards.
Go back to early in the ballgame when Jason Post timed up the quarterback cadence. Now, all of a sudden, the cadence may have been changed. I'm not going to sit up here and say it's been changed. I don't know, but it looks like it has been because now Syracuse jumping offside.
Offside defense. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
Small mistakes get into Paul Pasqualoni's team, which made a ton of little mistakes in the loss to Tennessee here on ESPN, September 5th, 34-33 in that one. And then they went to Michigan and had as impressive a road win as this school has had in its history. That's 110 years of a school that's in the top 15 all-time in wins. Barnett on play action. Wide open. Coleman, the other receiver, working the sidelines, stepped out of bounds, but he has a first down. David Byrd missed the tackle that allowed Coleman more yardage.
What happens sometimes when you got a Torrey Holt on the football field, Torrey Holt will work up the field, and you're so much concerned with him that all of a sudden Chris Coleman's going to break on the outside. But what's impressive is the yards after the catch here. Good sidestepping, good yardage. He's an impressive wide receiver. They got a lot of young, good young players. He's a redshirt junior.
His career per catch average is right about 20. And when Holt leaves next year, he's going to be a go-to guy and can handle it. Barnett, good bluffing. Again, Coleman wide open. First and goal, Wolfpack, and they are blowing through the Syracuse defense.
Mike, his play action, talking about Jamie Barnett, excellent on this play. He could have thrown the ball to Chris Coleman, which he did. He had Torrey Holt wide open for a touchdown. He had both of them because he froze the defensive backs and the linebackers of Syracuse with his play action fake. He's impressive.
And the Syracuse defense needs to take a timeout. And listen to the fans here at Carter Finley. And these programs having big wins this year, many people say that the victory for NC State over Florida State was the biggest. If there was a rival back in October of 67, they beat then number two Houston. That would be right up there in terms of rankings. But given what Florida State has done, dominating this conference for everyone except that Thursday night a few years ago at Scott Stadium against Virginia, that was the biggest win in this program's history.
And we were talking to Ian Rafferty the other day, and he said even after the Baylor game, students would still come up to him and say, thank you. And he said, for what? He said, for beating Florida State. And they lost the ball game, and they're still happy for the win over Florida State.
Thanks for letting me be a part of it.
Yes.
That's what the fans were saying. They took the goalpost that 1 mile down Trinity Church Road to Blue Ridge Road, Hillsborough Street, and the goalpost ended up at the Waffle House. First and goal, Wolfpack. The fullback, Butler, 2-1. Jeff Butler, the senior out of Florida. Only the eighth time he's carried the ball. Limited duty in his four-year college career. Very highly recruited player and a good baseball player as well.
Yeah, Florida, Alabama recruited him, and Notre Dame also. Jeff Butler almost gets in the end zone here, but he came to North Carolina State because they'd let him play baseball. Finally, he's getting his chance to play the fullback position.
Carlos King was in that spot last year.
He's now in the NFL. Play in of the ground. Ray Robinson, touchdown. Points, and he's got nine in his last name. And the way Syracuse is playing defense, he's going to get a chance for the last four.
What a push here. Ray Robinson, you see, he finally gets hit about a yard deep in the end zone. So you see the push of the offensive line. Ian Rafferty, John Fletcher, Justin Burroughs, Alex Rice, Jarvis Borum.
Mike O'Kane pulled a calf muscle when he leaped into the air against Florida State. That's why he didn't leave the ground. And Paul Pasqualoni's at the pulling your hair out point right now. Well, Torrey Holt did it early, and now it's the rest of the NC State offense, not just 81. He's grabbed the attention, and now the other guys are doing what they do best.
Well, that's what happens. All of a sudden, you start to figure that Torrey Holt's going to kill us. Then you start paying a lot of attention to him. Chris Coleman, then Ryan Hamrick hurt you with big pass receptions. And then Ray Robinson, Rashawn Spikes running the ball, Jamie Barnett on the option. So, as I said, this first half offensively has been a clinic for North Carolina State.
They've gone the long field three times, too, for touchdown drives. What an impressive performance by NC State. It's not every year that you have the chance to beat 2-11 in the country on your home field. They beat 2, and they've got 11 in an 18-point hole. Kevin Johnson will try to dig Syracuse out of it. And passing him on to Kitt. Kicks it short. Just deflected so it was not around for an NC State player to pick up. While we have a moment to the studio, Chris Fowler, what do you have for us?
Well, Mike is stunned. Coors and Herb Street will join me on the Coors Light Halftime Report. Highlights from the baseball playoffs. A visit with John Cooper on the eve of the big Buckeyes Nittany Lions game. And also one of the most entertaining pieces of hidden video we have ever shown on Thursday night. Stick around.
How about that for a tease? One of the most entertaining. And those are entertaining. So hidden video will keep you around at halftime. Like we've told you, the baseball game's still scoreless. We've got offense to boot here. Awful numbers for McNabb. Just 6 throws in 27 minutes and 35 seconds. Screen to Conrad. Snuffed out. Edrick Smith. That's the freshman from Alabama we told you about at the top of the show.
Mike, you got to get the ball out to Spotwood and Kevin Johnson now. The wide receivers, the screen play, played very well by Edrick Smith, the middle linebacker, number 53. Goes right to Rob Conrad. Read it right from the snap of the ball. Now you've got to get the ball out to your wide receivers. Kevin Johnson and Quentin Spotwood can break this game back in your favor.
They have just one catch in the first 28 minutes. After the loss of 4, second and 14, and flags come down.
This may be a substitution penalty on Syracuse because they had a receiver, Quentin Spotwood, came out of the huddle and it looked like he was going to line up on the outside. Then he ran to the sideline. So I think that's going to go against Syracuse.
Dead ball, illegal substitution on the offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Good job, coach.
Again, they're rattled. Now, Syracuse is rattled a little bit by this first half. It was a late substitution. One catch by the two excellent receivers by Syracuse. They'll be a factor in the second half. Still, it's not a big enough lead for North Carolina State to rest against this Syracuse offensive football team.
Jeff Lowe is the receiver at the top of the screen. It's second and 19. And they'll run some option. McNabb fumbled it. And it's recovered by Jeff Pilon, the right tackle.
Yeah, they're doing a little talking to Donovan McNabb now. He made a mistake there, but I wouldn't. Sleeping dogs, let them lie. Levar Fisher, number 44, with the hit on Donovan McNabb, but they just don't look like they're in sync. They had the first drive, went right down the field and score. Sometimes you can score too easy, too fast, but they have come back and they've just been discombobulated. The option here, he doesn't keep the ball in, carrying it like a loaf of bread. Gets hit, the ball gets hit by Levar Fisher. And you talk about a big play. Now that would have been another seven.
Fisher's another freshman. A lot of youth on this field for NC State. Third down, and they run with Conrad, who gets to the 22, but that will be short of the first down. NC State can't stop the clock, and if I had a guess, Paul Pasqualoni's just going to head off to the locker room and say, get out. That's exactly what they're going to do. Torrey Holt had the big first quarter. His teammates have checked it over in the second quarter. Donovan McNabb, who was outstanding in the big house in front of 111,000, slow, limping, tired, coming off the field. At the half, the Pack shocking Syracuse by 18. Here's Chris and Lee and Kirk.
Coach Tirico, we're pretty surprised back here in the studio. Amazing what the Wolfpack are capable of when they focus. Two terrible first half this season, or as they might be up there in the top 12 or 15 where Syracuse is ranked for an primetime NFL football.
Quarter. Hope you enjoyed halftime back in the studio. We welcome you back to Raleigh. Mike Tirico, Mike Godfrey, Dr. Jerry Punch, number 11, Syracuse being shocked by North Carolina State. Not that State's winning, that they're winning by 18, and they are absolutely, totally shutting down Syracuse's potent passing attack, Mike.
Mike, two things. Kevin Johnson, Quentin Spotwood, not a factor in the first half. Have to become a factor if they're going to win this football game. Third down conversions. North Carolina State, 5 out of 7. Syracuse have just shot themselves every chance. I mean, they're make mistakes, penalties, they're 0-for-5.
And Syracuse made about half of its third down conversions coming into the game. Well, if Donovan McNabb is to live up to the advanced billing of this season, he needs help from Quentin Spotwood and needs to play better. That's as poor a half as McNabb's played in some time. Set for the second half kickoff, Leak and Robinson back to receive, and it's Eric Leak, the receiver for NC State, pulled down at the 12-yard line. Very nice special teams play by J.R. Johnson. Second time we've called the DB.
Torrey Holt had an excellent first quarter. Separates from the defensive back, shows his speed upfield. Fast in pads. The North Carolina State coaches said he's the fastest player ever here in pads. You see the smooth route running, breaks out of the route, makes the catch. 45 yards after the catch, Mike, in this ball game.
More than half his total. NC State has gone the long field three different times in the first half. They start on the ground with Rashawn Spikes and the relatively unknown NC State offensive line really clearing some holes. Here's Dr. Jerry Punch again.
At halftime, talking with Syracuse head coach Paul Pasqualoni, he said, Doc, offensively, we've got to get back into our pattern to run our offense. We have been out of sync. We have made mistakes. We have made miscues. Very successful with our power attack in the first half. We've got to get back there defensively. We have had trouble stopping them, particularly on third down with the option. The option has surprised us. We did not prepare to see Barnett run the option, and thus he has been very effective. We have got to stop that third down play in the second half.
Jerry, thanks. The first down pickup by Spikes was 6. Barnett to the air. There is the tailback, Spikes, for a first down. Colin Greenwood ties him up at the 28. First and 10, they move the chains again.
And Spikes has been a big player in this ball game also. 77 touchdowns he scored in high school. We talked to George DeLeon. He mentioned the brace on Jamie Barnett. They didn't figure the option. They haven't shown much of it. Big third down plays, as Jerry Punch said, have been on the option with Jamie Barnett carrying the football.
Spikes, that strong, powerful runner behind him. The fullback Butler has done a quiet, solid job tonight. And there is Butler for a rare carry. But effective. North Carolina State was at the top of the ACC in rushing last year. This year, although it's only a three-game sample, they are at the bottom of the ACC in rushing, just about 100 per game.
can they come up here in the second half and run the ball effectively?
Well, they're going to move up in the statistics after this ball game because they're running the ball very, very well. And their offensive line is having their way with the defensive line of Syracuse.
94 yards already tonight, so they've exceeded their game average. Spikes. Can he get to the corner? No, good speed shown by Keith Bullock, who pulls Spikes down.
And, Mike, what happens when all of a sudden you have a great receiver, Torrey Holt, trying to double him and do different things, and then they all of a sudden North Carolina State runs the football, and next thing you do now, you start to get the safety involved. Now look it up here. The wide receiver is a one-on-one on the outside, so the running game is forcing Syracuse to involve a safety to try to stop the running game. It means Torrey Holt, and it means Chris Coleman will have some one-on-one coverage and running downs.
Six defensive backs for Syracuse. On third down, Barnett scrambles. Punt by Leak. And he has the first down at the 42. Boy, it looked like he wasn't going to hold on there for a minute. But he does it, and Barnett, just that half second to buy him one more beat to throw the ball, helped him pick up the first down.
And that's what he does the best. He starts moving around the pocket. He steps up. Here's Eric Leak. He's open. Ian McIntosh is taken off. He felt like the ball was going to go somewhere else. Jamie Barnett buys a little time, gets the ball to Eric Leak. The chains move again.
6 of 8 on third down conversions. What a night for North Carolina State's offense. Now do they think about going big from the 43? Barnett looks long for Holt. Wait, a great catch in traffic at the 20-yard line. Flag down back where the pass was thrown. Oh, it's coming back.
Yeah, tough, tough call for North Carolina State. Jamie Barnett threw that ball to Torrey Holt. Torrey Holt just ran by again the secondary of Syracuse and made a nice catch. Uses his 6'2 frame.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
The race is a 37-yard completion.
And, Mike, really, they're in pretty good position here with being able to double cover him. They've got a safety in a corner to try to help on him, but Torrey Holt, I don't think they realize how fast Torrey Holt is to make that catch. David Byrd, who's a speedster himself, and then Torrey Holt has a way of going up and catching the football.
You saw both right there, the ability to pull away and then go up in traffic and make the catch. The hold brings it back, makes it first and 24. Try to get some chunks with Sean Spikes. With about 4, it was Ricky Simpkins, the sophomore out of Middle Village, Queens, New York, on the tackle, and a late flag comes in from the secondary. Maybe a frustrated Syracuse team. Sure was. Well, there's a lack of poise. You have first and about a quarter of the field, and you give them the first down back, frustrating not only Paul Pasqualoni, but George DeLeon, former offensive coordinator here, after a year as an offensive line coach of the San Diego Chargers, has come back to take over the Syracuse defense.
And he takes over for Norm Gerber, a longtime Syracuse outstanding football coach. That, again, the mistakes that Syracuse have made tonight have just really killed them.
It's not the number, yeah, but the timing.
Timing was everything in those penalties.
Go back to the first NC State drive, a hold on a third down that otherwise would have been incomplete. Poles running in. This time they pick up the blitz, and Barnett steps up, and he has Holt. He is unbelievable. First down at the 20.
They're not getting a jam on him on the line of scrimmage, Mike. He's running crossing routes. And when we talked to him the other day, he said he admires Jerry Rice, his performance on the field, but more importantly, his work ethic. You see, he gets a free release here. Now a linebacker's trying to run with him, Stan Gibbs, and you can't cover him with a linebacker. But he said, if I can have the same kind of work ethic Jerry Rice has or better, then I'm going to be a great receiver and a dominant receiver.
Over 100 yards, again, is Torrey Holt.
Ninth time in his career, the fullback Butler busts through the line, gets to the 15. It will be second and five. And Mike, when you have a talented quarterback and an exceptional wide receiver, they can do a lot of things, but you also need a creative scheme and game plan to keep getting him the ball in different places and different ways. And this NC State coaching staff has done a great job of doing that.
They do, Mike. They move him all around. Sometimes he's the outside receiver, the inside receiver. Sometimes he's a single receiver, and they move him around so that no one can get a bump on him.
Alone up at the top of the screen, they run again. The fullback, Harold Jackson, the redshirt freshman, gets his first career carry, and the youngster out of Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, gains a couple of yards.
Well, I don't know how he stands in the Heisman voting, but he's making a statement here tonight that Torrey Holt should be considered for the Heisman Trophy. He is the best receiver I've seen probably in the last couple years in college football. A dominant receiver. They said that 80% of the passes that were thrown in the Florida State game were thrown to Torrey Holt, but he has an escapability at the line of scrimmage. He runs very nice patterns. He's got great hands to go up and catch the football, and he's physical. So he has everything.
The injured player who was down is now walking off under his own power, but limping off for Syracuse. It's Eric Downey. Here's Dr. Jerry Punch.
Talking about Torrey Holt's summer work ethic, he went running all summer long, but not just running sprints. What he would do is he would run four 16-play quarters, and he would run the NC State offense a quick out and then run back to the huddle. He'd run a streak and run back to the huddle, a crossing pattern and run back to the huddle. 16 plays meant one quarter, and he would run an entire ball game, 72 plays every afternoon to prepare himself to be ready to run all night long during this 1998 season.
Up at 7:30 to lift weights, got it going before that work. Barnett rolls, incomplete. On the move, trying to get it to the tight end. Devon Smith, let me correct myself. It was Ricky Simpkins who was injured for Syracuse and limped off. And it was Eric Downing who checked into the orange lineup. NC State stopped on third down. We'll try a field goal.
And if he makes this field goal, it's worth three letters.
That's right. Well, for 3 points, right?
3 points. Jamie Barnett frustrated on that throw.
He made a good pass as well. Danny Duskevich, walk-on kicker. Officially, this will be a 31-yard field goal attempt. Nice snap, got it down. Oh, and it's going right. It all goes right. Duskevich hits the three. It's all going the way of the Wolfpack tonight. NC State leads by 21.
ESPN's presentation of Thursday Night Football is brought to you by Paramount Pictures. A Night at the Roxbury starts Friday, October 2nd, rated PG-13. And by AC Delco Automotive Parts. AC Delco. If you're not asking for it, you're asking for it.
North Carolina State leading Syracuse 31-10. A third of the way through the third quarter, Kevin Johnson back deep to receive the kick.
Not out of reach yet for Syracuse, but gaining.
Getting darn close. Little pooch kick, try to surprise. Fielded by the upback, Kevin O'Neill. 27, the linebacker O'Neill. Showed good hands, and the drive will start from the 34. Donovan McNabb had a bad first half.
Yeah, he's capable of coming out of this thing. Oh, the first half, he looked to the right and he came back to the left. Got his first pass picked off this year. Came back trying to throw the football, but you can see the pressure that North Carolina State's had on him. Then he ran the option before half, fumbled the football. Very fortunate that Syracuse recovered that ball. But you expect big things out of great players, and I expect him to have a big second half.
Play action for first down. Needs to step up and throw, and he does to Johnson, just short of midfield. Here's Jerry Punch.
At halftime in the NC State locker room, Mike O'Kane had some very serious discussions with his players. The defensive coaches were talking about the fact that they made some mistakes defensively in the first half, but their intensity made up for it. They have got to continue to move around defensively. If they can find us defensively, they will be able to block us because they are very, very strong up front. Just before they came out, Mike O'Kane told his entire team to close their eyes and be quiet and listen. Listen to what their hearts are telling them. If they come out here and play 30 minutes, they'll come back in as winners, not only one of the best football teams in the state, but maybe one of the best football teams in the country.
As Chris said at halftime, Doc, this team is one half away from being, he was right, a top 10, top 15 team. McNabb picked up a first down last time. This time goes down. Edrick Smith, the true freshman from Alabama, has been all over the field tonight.
Well, they're proud of him in Tuscaloosa. Joe Pate, the coach here at North Carolina State that has a lot of ties to Alabama, went right in Southeastern Conference territory and recruited Edrick Smith. Coverage down the field's good, but really, Edrick Smith made that play, stopped Donovan McNabb.
Edrick Smith's dad worked when his high school games were going on, so he couldn't go to his son's games. Edrick enjoyed the time with his dad watching the film of the games to relive the moments that his dad couldn't see live. Loss of eight. Just got it off in time. Sloppy, sloppy, sloppy from the offensive line to the receiver routes. Nobody came back to the ball.
And we're talking about Torrey Holt, Heisman hopes. Tonight, Donovan McNabb's are taking a hit.
And let's not cloud this in just the struggles for the Syracuse offense, which has not been good. This NC State defense showed as a secondary how good they can be. Chris Wenke is young and inexperienced, but they did it. Everybody says Wenke did a bad job at a bad game against Florida State. The Rough Riders in this secondary played a very, very good game.
11 interceptions this year.
Most in the nation. First down awaits at the State 41. A lot of real estate to cover. Not going to get it that way. What a job by the Wolfpack defense tonight. They've held Syracuse to 153 yards.
And that's another freshman, Mike Levar Fisher, making that tackle. Good pressure by the defensive front. Now Donovan McNabb with long yardage. They'll let him try to run for the first down, but Levar Fisher, 6'2", 217-pound freshman, makes a tackle.
Doug Duncan to kick. Dangerous man awaits in Torrey Holt. Coming after. Returnable. Holt from the 19 made the first man miss, but didn't have his feet going forward. Had a sidestep out of bounds. Net of 35 after a 40-yard kick. Frustrated. Aggravated. Down 21. He was the man who pulled down Donovan McNabb on the third down that forced Syracuse to punt. His North Carolina State defense has really done the job. There's been a lot of heads going left and right on that Syracuse sideline while you were away. Barnett, the NC State offense. Start with Rashawn Spikes. 7 yards on first down. NC State struggled in the first half on first down. Much better here in the second half.
Well, you got to credit the offensive line again for North Carolina State. They're just opening up big holes for the offensive backs, Rashawn Spikes, Ray Robinson, Jeff Butler to run through.
Led by center Justin Burroughs. Ian Rafferty, that left tackle, number 60. Just inside the tight end there. Second and three. The toss to Spikes for the first down and more. At the 43. Give him 11.
And Mike, you're at a part of the ball game where Syracuse has to try to do something to try to stop the offense. Now here you see a corner coming on the weak side, but Jamie Barnett has the right play called. He's running away from it with Rashawn Spikes. But now what happens when you start to man up on those wide receivers? Big play opportunities come for Torrey Holt, Chris Coleman.
Holt's top of the screen, fullback Butler. The Butler does it, fumble the football, and Syracuse recovered.
Biggest play of the ball game right there. Jeff Butler, complete control by North Carolina State. Jason Poles recovers the fumble. Now, will the real Syracuse team stand up or not?
Mark it down, 31-10, as you see, with 6.5 left in the third.
A bend back play, a little fullback belly, and Jeff Butler does a great job of cutting back. And then he tries to take on Phil Nash. Phil Nash gets his helmet on the football, and that is the biggest play of this football game, Syracuse, is to get back in it.
That's the guy who's only carried 15 times in his 4 years at NC State.
Johnson and Spotwood have to become factors right here.
McNabb to the air, this time has time. Johnson hangs on, nearly lost it on the way out. Midfield, same way the last drive started.
Kevin Johnson's dream was to play quarterback. He visited Syracuse and Nebraska, decided on Syracuse, got beat out by Donovan McNabb, worked with Marvin Harrison, the former Syracuse receiver, on his routes. He's an unselfish player. He said, God has a way of working, and I'm at a wide receiver position. A lot of the pro scouts are looking at him tonight.
Syracuse had has eight wide receivers or tight ends currently on NFL rosters. McNabb runs some option. The late pitch to McIntosh. He picks up a first down and really gets thrown out of bounds by Jason Perry's forearm. That's the top tackler on that team, and you see why.
Mike, you just see right now, Syracuse backs to the wall. If they're going to fight, they're going to fight right now to get back in this football game. The wide receivers tonight, 3 catches for 40 yards. Kevin Johnson, 2 in the second half. Mm-hmm. Quentin Spotwood had his in the first half. They have to become factors if they're going to win this football game.
Spotwood's 8, Johnson's 12. Hanging out on the same side of the field for first and 10 in NC State territory at the 40. Option where the receivers were. McNabb got a nice block from Conrad and got 16 first down yards to the 24.
Rob Conrad, wearing the famous number 44 at Syracuse, comes out and will lead this blocking for Donovan McNabb. He gets a block on Jason Perry, number 9, the linebacker. Good blocks by the wide receiver. This is what Syracuse does best. Option, passing to the outside, inside with Conrad.
Ernie Davis, Floyd Little, Jim Brown wore that number. Even took on basketball popularity at the school. Derek Coleman, John Wallace. McNabb to the air. Syracuse moves into the red zone as senior Darryl Daniel comes up with the catch. It'll be second and short. Baseball tomorrow on ESPN. The playoffs continue. What great coverage it's been. We've enjoyed watching. Baseball tonight starts at 3:30. Then a Fall Friday at Fenway. Brett Saberhagen and Charles Nagy. Yankees, Rangers on NBC tomorrow night. All the games on ESPN Radio. Wherever you go, you'll be able to follow the playoffs. Cubs lead 1-0 in the 8th inning. Trying to force games 3 and 4 at Wrigley Field. We'll keep you updated on that. No reason to leave us. On second and short, wide open is Conrad. Syracuse will have first and goal from the 9-yard line.
Now Donovan McNabb's looking like the Donovan McNabb we expected. Except for the first drive, North Carolina State, you got to give them credit. They pressured Donovan McNabb. They won the battle to the line of scrimmage. They blitzed linebackers, Edrick Smith, Levar Fisher. Jeff Snipes, the defensive coordinator, co-defensive coordinators, had a nice plan, but now Syracuse seems to be in rhythm.
Jeff's been a coach here 13 years. Third year he and Kent Frigg share those duties. Johnson top of the screen in motion. First and goal, McNabb. Touchdown to Brominski, the tight end. They love to throw to the tight ends in the red zone, and they do it again. Syracuse answers on what Mike said was the crucial drive of the game.
And Mike, go back to that fumble, because North Carolina State had everything going their way. Syracuse, the door's open now for them to get back in this football game. That was a nice drive.
Looked more like the first drive when Syracuse was able to run and set up all its other stuff.
And Kevin Johnson, big factor in the drive, 2 catches.
Nate Trout on to add the extra point. And it's a 2-touchdown game with a quarter and 4:40 to go. Donovan McNabb had struggled before that drive. He was 5 of 6, including the touchdown to Bromenski, his second of the season. Well, Donovan McNabb was struggling, 4 of 7 before that drive, but 5 of 6, taking Syracuse down the field for the touchdown. And you saw earlier working on some snaps with the backup center, P.J. Alexander. Could be an exchange change for Syracuse come next drive.
And it looks like confidence in his face right there. Mm-hmm. You saw the pictures. Our guys did a great job of getting the pictures on the sideline where he showed so much frustration. It looks like now the light bulb's going on what defense is doing for North Carolina State.
Peter Ferris with the kickoff. Drives leak into the end zone, and it's a rare touchback with Syracuse kicking off. Jerry Punch.
Well, this is as subdued a sideline as I've seen at NC State since the game was kicked off earlier tonight. NC State has done so much with intensity and emotion, but after that fumble and then very quick and efficient drive by Syracuse, the NC State sideline very, very quiet and subdued here on this drive. We'll see if it makes a difference in the effectiveness of their offense.
I'll tell you what would subdue them even more, Doc, is a 3-and-out. And that's what Syracuse defense has to give right now.
There's a holding penalty on North Carolina State on the kickoff. Now that is strange. Very rare that you see that on a touchback. So they sort this out. Again, Big East referees, ACC referees, when Syracuse and North Carolina State played their great one in the Carrier Dome last year that ended up 32-31 NC State.
Holding by the receiving team during the kick. Penalty is declined. 1st and 10.
Okay, key play in the last drive, North Carolina State in complete control of this football game. Jeff Butler is going to get hit by Phil Nash. Ball pops out. Jason Poles recovers. And we have a 14-point football game. And this is a big series right here because Syracuse, time-wise, 4:33 on the clock, they need to turn it back over to their offense.
From the 20, Jamie Barnett leads the Wolfpack offense, and Rashawn Spikes runs into Poles and gets about 4 yards. After Poles stopped him, Stan Gibbs wrapped him up. You know, this is why college football is fun, because they are 19 and 20, and in some cases for NC State, true freshman, 18 years old, and the emotions can change so quick. In the pros, the more mature players, sure, they're affected by emotion, but they can deal with it better. They've been through it. That's why college football really grabs you every weekend, and these are the moments that make more mature men out of these players.
And this is a relatively young North Carolina State football team, so when you get the ups and downs, it may affect them more.
2nd and 5, Barnett. Nearly intercepted. He was trying to get to the tight end, and David Byrd tried to make the spectacular play and come up with the INT.
You know, I think Jamie Barnett wanted Torrey Holt, but Torrey Holt almost runs into the official here. He has to stop right here. And he almost picked off.
A lot of times you can use that official as a positive screen for you.
Let's see if they were on the option. No, they're going to shotgun it right here. I thought maybe the option play. They've had so much success with it.
Poles eyeing the quarterback. 3rd and 5. Barnett found some space. Found Holt for the first down again.
Big. Big, big play. All made possible by Jamie Barnett stepping around. Torrey Holt working against David Byrd. It's his own coverage. Poles tries to pick him up, stays active, made the catch, never gave up on his route.
Poles is shaken up for Syracuse as Holt goes over 130 yards. Well, with these big numbers, the Holt numbers continue to, I guess, fill up the pages on that website that they started here at NC State for everybody to check out the numbers and the updates. I'm going to try to do some quick math here. 29 catches for him for nearly 500 yards.
And Mike, in 97 against Florida State, he had 5 touchdowns. So you talk about the great Florida State defense, he had 5 scores against him.
Hope, you see. You see his dad. And it's nearly 600 yards, not nearly 500 yards. For the season now, there's Odell Schaffer, his dad.
Math wasn't one of your courses at Syracuse, was it?
You know what? Math was good. The verbal was the problem, as you hear for 3.5 hours every Thursday. First and 10 from the 39. Ray Robinson, the freshman, is the tailback now. Back to the fullback, Butler. He really got hit hard there and got a couple of yards. Duke Pettijohn and Phil Nash in on the tackle.
Again, Syracuse moving the safety, Phil Nash, up. He made the tackle on Jeff Butler, but that on first down ensures that Torrey Holt, Chris Coleman are going to have one-on-one on the outside with the eight-man front being used by Syracuse to try to stop the run play on first down.
Nash's safety partner, Poles, was injured, so Charles Burton, redshirt freshman out of Texas, who's been in the lineup often tonight, is in there again. Barnett to the air. Is Holt inbounds? No, they say out of bounds. He was sliding and his feet were near the sideline. That's a very tough play to make and tough call to make. Third down coming.
Again, it shows you his concentration, though, because as he was slipping down, he still made the catch. He thought he was in bounds. Here's the play. Well, I would think that's a catch, Mike. And a good slide.
Still hasn't been out of bounds.
No.
As Madden told you in the title of his book, one knee equals 2 feet. Two knees would equal 4 feet. They try to pick up another third down. And they do, a spectacular catch by Leak. No, incomplete.
No, they're giving
it. No, it is. Okay. There was an official back there who was waving incomplete, but Leak put the ball down, his first down. What a great play.
And Jamie Barnett again delivering that ball right on the money. Eric Leak's going to work. You see the safety come up. Here's a safety right here, which means man coverage on the outside. North Carolina State picks up. It's a zone blitz is what it is.
Wow.
Ian McIntosh on the coverage.
Leak wanted that ball more, and he got it. Great play from the 45. Blitz coming, look out. Oh, Barnett did a nice job to hold on as David Bird's corner blitz forces a six-yard loss.
And that's forcing Syracuse defensively to come after Jamie Barnett. David Bird, the weak side corner, is going to come on a corner fire to the blind side of the quarterback. He doesn't see it coming. Comes right from this side on the wide receiver. Jamie Barnett doesn't see it coming.
Some of the NFL influence that George DeLeon here at the San Diego Chargers, now the defensive coordinator, has brought pressure from different places. The back spikes, meets Bullock, but a flag is down.
Mike, this could be a big call because I think it's on number 55, Todd Boyle holding, and he is about 7 or 6 yards in the backfield. So all of a sudden the flags are coming out here on North Carolina State.
You can see the referee did signal to one of his fellow officials. It was 55.
Holding on the offense, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, second down.
Todd Boyle, number 55, right here is going to be called for the hold. And I'd say he's got his right hand around the neck.
The referee threw it. Donald Dinkins was the player that was being held.
Mike, ordinarily, second and 28, tough play, but when you have Torrey Holt on the field, becomes like a first down.
Barnett, wide open with spikes. He couldn't hold on. He had another 10 yards to run. Just couldn't get his feet to slow down to catch the ball.
And this is what happened to Syracuse in the first half. Syracuse didn't make the plays, and all of a sudden, North Carolina State misses an opportunity like that. Rashawn Spikes, as you said, would have had 10 more yards before a Syracuse player would have even been able to get to him. In the first half, they made these plays. In the second half, they're starting to misfire.
Paul Pasqualoni's defense gave up a huge third and long on Torrey Holt's first catch of the night. He picked up 41 yards in the first quarter. They need 28 here. Have to get to the Syracuse 35 for a first down. Barnett runs it and is shy of midfield. After the pickup of 12, State will punt. And this has been a concern for them this year because of injuries at the kicking spot.
Well, and Spotwood again, we talked about him this entire ballgame. He has not been a factor.
Spotwood has struggled with punt returns this year. People not kicking to him. Syracuse is coming after Jesse Wade, and they pull off for the return. Spotwood fair catching it at the 13, 37-yard kick, and Wade did a very nice job. The starting punter, Scott Earwood, injured. That's why they've had such change at the position. So this Friday, tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, got to watch the Deuce. The debut of Friday Night Fights, main event, Andrew Galata, Tim Witherspoon, a good one, and Muhammad Ali will be our featured fighter for our classic fight segment. Brian Kenny, Max Kellerman host the most in-depth and comprehensive boxing show on television, Friday Night Fights, debuting tomorrow night on the Deuce. Looking forward to that series start.
And Mike, all week I've had to try to separate you being a Syracuse graduate and Jerry Punch, a North Carolina State graduate. Both of you have been near blows all week.
Oh yeah, and the two of us. We've had a lot of fun this week. This has been a very entertaining game. McNabb to the air on first down. Kevin Johnson. That's the third first down catch for Johnson in as many drops.
And you talk about matchups in a ball game. Here's Mike Tirico, Syracuse graduate. Youthful looking. Here, number 55, a quarterback, Jerry Punch. Look at that vertical jump right there. An inch. Doc, no face mask.
You know, Mike,
that's the matchup this week.
My picture's bad. Doc's is pathetic.
Doc got off the ground that high.
Option for McNabb to McIntosh. Great play by Clayton White. That's the second time he has held Syracuse to no gain or negative yardage. NC State's fans now back in it. Syracuse heads a little closer in that quarter, but now the fourth quarter's ahead. The number 11 Syracuse is in a two-touchdown hole. Now the fourth quarter. 11th-ranked Syracuse trails by 14. And for all the accolades they got for going to Michigan and blowing out the Wolverines in three quarters, it will be wasted if they can't come back here in the final 15 minutes. Just like NC State's loss to Baylor. Johnson again. Kevin Johnson, a little burst. He stepped out of bounds, but picked up another first down. They're finding number 12, the senior receiver, again. Still, that pass put Syracuse over 100 passing yards for the game. They were 90 after three. NC State has rolled up 425 yards, and look at the third down conversions. State, 8 of 12, and Syracuse, 0 of 6.
And Mike, you're right. Kevin Johnson now becomes the most important player on this football field for Syracuse. He and Quentin Spotwood, the second half of this fourth quarter, can turn this game back in Syracuse's favor.
He's out. Two tight ends are in. Kyle McIntosh gets across midfield, pulled down by Clayton White. Second leading tackler on the NC State team.
White makes the tackle.
Special teams player of the year for the Wolfpack last year. And he had a huge play in a huge game. The interception to clinch it against East Carolina. They brought down the goalpost after that win here at Carter Finley as well.
They took it to the fork in the road, right?
They didn't take that one
there
to the waffle.
They
took that to the IHOP, right? Coach, just make sure everybody's covered here. On second
all breakfast places.
Kevin Johnson in motion. McNabb in some trouble. Look out. Third sack of the night for the Wolfpack, and Jeff Fisher made it at the end, and a penalty marker comes in really, really late. I mean, just 2 seconds ago, way back in the secondary. There was pushing and jostling on the sideline with Spotwood.
Head ball, personal foul on the off.
And that's going to be 15 more tacked on to this.
15-yard penalty.
Edrick Smith, number 53, starts this whole problem for Donovan McNabb because nobody picks up the linebacker. Jeff Fisher makes the tackle and then the penalty on Quentin Spotwood.
Instead of third and 24, third and 39.
Yeah, they always catch the second guy sometimes in a shoving match.
Momentum swings back to NC State. They have to get to the state 42 for a first down. Good luck. I thought he was over the line of scrimmage, and he was. Pass caught at the 40, but McNabb took a step close to the 20. He crossed the line of scrimmage.
Making every mistake you can make. Good officiating right here.
Mm-hmm. Linesman Joe Greaser made the call.
Donovan McNabb, again, the rush has really forced him out of the pocket. Steps forward and then steps back late, but threw the ball across the line. Here you see the linesman.
You can see it there perfectly. Great replay, guys. Our director, Mike Schwab, our producer, Tim Corrigan, the pictures that detail the complete frustration tonight for Donovan McNabb in Syracuse. And now Doug Duncan must kick to Torrey Holt. You've seen what he can do as a receiver. Hasn't had much of a chance to do it as a kick returner.
No, and he could bring this back. Now, there's a wind into the Syracuse punter's face here.
They can't even pick up the first down with the kick. They needed 44 yards, and they're going to get a lot less than that as Holt makes the fourth fair catch after a 29-yard punt. Momentum back to the Pack. They lead by 14. At home, a double-digit underdog leads by double digits. North Carolina State, 31, Syracuse, 17, and a great drive start because of undisciplined, poor plays by Syracuse. A lot of penalties. The NC State drive starts at the 42. Chris Coleman, that hurts his yards per catch average. Guy averages over 20 and picked up just about 7.
Well, Jamie Barnett knew something was going to happen here on first down, and it becomes a corner blitz, which now leaves your wide receiver open on the hitch play on the outside. Chris Coleman, there's a safety. Phil Nash has to get over there to make that play.
Something like that, usually total adjustment quarterback.
Total adjustment
receiver.
By the quarterback and receiver.
Coleman, a junior. Barnett, a junior as well. He plays Jose Lariano when he was a freshman. Speed by Ray Robinson. Turns the corner for a first down. The freshman out of Hilton Head.
Michael Kane was talking about Ray Robinson the other day. South Carolina, Clemson recruited him. They recruited 5 running backs, and they were going to move some of them. The first time that Ray Robinson carried the ball in a scrimmage, he made 2 cuts, and he knew he wasn't going to be moved. They were going to keep him at tailback.
Those 24 senior year touchdowns, part of his 56 career touchdowns as a running back in Hilton Head. Split backs has meant pass all night. And the pass has been there all night. One of the backs, Robinson, 2-5. First and goal, Wolfpack. 22 yards.
Ray Robinson out of the backfield against linebackers. Bring him right out of the backfield. Here he is on an angle play right here, working inside the linebackers. Marlon Greenwood and Matt Claus, Stan Gibbs.
Well, the offense didn't get it done, and the defense has it all night. 463 yards allowed. And State looking for a knockout punch. Robinson stopped after he gives up about a yard, and here's Jerry again.
You guys talking about the true freshman Ray Robinson. A lot of people here at NC State remember Tremaine Stevens, who graduated a year ago. I know it's early and he's only played three football games, but Dick Portee and some of the offensive coaches at NC State say he does remind them a little bit of Tremaine, although he may be faster. He may remind them more of the great Ted Brown. One of just three retired jerseys here at NC State. Ted Brown was a great one and played with the Minnesota Vikings, but Ray Robinson still just a freshman.
Tremaine Stevens on the Chargers roster now, Jerry. Second and goal. Looking end zone. Barnett might run for it. Will run for it. Touchdown, Wolfpack. Close to Diskevich's complete jersey here.
And Mike, the happiest player on the North Carolina State team right now is Jeff Butler, and he made a good block for Jamie Barnett.
Butler, who fumbled earlier.
Had that fumble, and he made a good block to spring Jamie Barnett into that end zone.
The walk-on gets his 8th point of the night. Got 9 letters in that last name. He's getting close. Before we leave, a penalty marker is down, so hang on 1 second. A flag is down after the touchdown run by Jamie Barnett. Mike O'Kane had reason to celebrate. Penalties on Syracuse. The point will stand, and NC State leads 38-17. Thursday night football continues from Raleigh. Syracuse tries to mount a comeback after this. Frustrating losses and poor starts have typified the last few years for Syracuse. They've shown great resiliency in coming back to win 9 games the last 3 years. But the players who've been around this program for a while, and there are a lot of them on this field, like the senior Johnson, know that it's another hole that they've dug themselves that they're going to have to spend the rest of the year trying to dig out. They lost to Tennessee, won at Michigan, beat Rutgers, got to 2-1, and a win here would have been 3-1 and a good start. What's happened? NC State has scored 38. There's a personal foul in the Wolfpack, so they kick from their own 20. Kevin Johnson advances the kickoff across midfield, and Syracuse's drive will start at the 46 of the Wolfpack. And here's Dr. Jerry Punch again.
First thing with Bill Polian, the president of the Indianapolis Colts and one of the best at assessing talent in the National Football League. And Bill, I've got to ask you your assessment of Torrey Holt.
Well, he's a really scintillating player. He's exciting to watch. He's got great hands, great speed, great leaping ability. He's got a great feel for running routes and getting open. It really is exciting. It's fun to come and watch him.
What about Donovan McNabb, the great Syracuse quarterback?
Well, State's done a great job of bottling him up tonight. He really is a magnificent athlete. He's got great escape ability, really a strong arm. He's improved a lot as a passer over the years, and he's a better player than State's allowed him to show tonight.
Rob Conrad, the great fullback. I mean, what an effort he puts on blocking downfield as well as carrying the football.
Yeah, well, he's a complete fullback. He can block, he can catch, he can run, he's elusive, and he can run with great power. And again, great credit to Mike O'Kane and his staff tonight for doing a great job bottling up those two tremendous weapons, because they really are good football players.
Hey, Bill, thanks for coming down. We appreciate your input.
My pleasure.
Bill Polian, who called it the talent bubble tonight, indeed, a lot of talent on this football.
Jerry, after the incompletion, McNabb can't escape a 4th sack, and that's what Bill Polian was talking about. We've seen McNabb even have shoes taken off him and make spectacular plays out of the pocket, but Rashad Streets, Corey Smith, and the defensive line for NC State tonight has really closed down that pocket.
Mike, the best pass defense is when you put the quarterback on his back. Rashad Streets just beats the block, I believe, of Mark Banowitz, and got right inside and tackled the feet of Donovan McNabb.
Sophomores, redshirt freshmen, all across that defensive front. They're without Greg Garrett, their defensive end, who's a senior, maybe their best rush man. Haven't missed him. That tells you the effort and the scheme tonight. On 3rd and 15, Syracuse hasn't picked up a 3rd down conversion tonight. Still haven't.
Well, they got to go for this one.
They'll be 4.5 yards short.
Donovan McNabb again not being able to set up, not being able to find his receivers downfield because of the rush of North Carolina State. You were talking about Greg Derrick, who's their leading pass rusher, and he's not even playing in the ballgame tonight. The 6'6", 281-pound senior.
51,200 and Phil Carter Finley on a cool, breezy first night in October. And they're going to try to help their defense on fourth and four. Kevin Johnson picked up the first down. Got 12 yards, too, to the 28. Well, when the chips have been down here in the second half, Johnson has answered the call after being shut out in the first half. 5 catches here in the second half.
And Donovan McNabb shows you his arm strength here because he's under pressure. You're going to see the route by Kevin Johnson, just a square out. And the ball, again, the pressure's coming on Donovan McNabb, but the running ability, the former quarterback, Kevin Johnson. Tom Osborne had both Donovan McNabb and Kevin Johnson on recruiting visits.
Johnson out, Spotwood in. First and 10. McNabb runs a little option. And gets close to a first down inside the 20. Mike, I remember when you and Ron Franklin did the Syracuse, North Carolina game, McNabb's freshman year. It was right before game time, and they still hadn't told anybody who was going to be the starting quarterback. The battle was that close in spring ball and in the summer, and sure, the coaches were playing a little bit coy as well to try to keep the advantage over North Carolina. But Pasqualoni went with Donovan McNabb, and the results, although poor tonight, have been overall extraordinary.
And Kevin Johnson rebounded. He went to wide receiver. Marvin Harrison taught him how to run routes. He said Marvin Harrison calls him every Monday and talks about his game and talks about the Syracuse game. But I think you have to look at Kevin Johnson as being very unselfish. He got beat out for the quarterback position. He decided to move to wide receiver. Now the NFL will take a good shot at Kevin Johnson because they know he's a team player, unselfish guy.
It's a great small lesson to kind of pass along. Those of you cruising around for SportsCenter at the top of the hour, it will be your way as soon as we're done here in Raleigh. Dan and Kenny, complete baseball coverage. Then baseball tonight right after Carl Ravitch, Peter Gammons, and Al Leiter of the New York Mets breaking down all the playoff action. Syracuse had the opportunity with the change being moved to have the clock stop. Couldn't get organized and had to take their first time out of the half. 32 left in the game before Dan and Kenny in SportsCenter. Syracuse down 21 in the red zone. Getting pretty close to beating the team from the Carrier Dome tonight. High formation, two receivers. They almost got McNabb off the start. They faked the reverse they ran earlier, and McNabb runs it very close to first down yardage. And they ran the reverse on that same play just in the second quarter to Maurice Jackson. This time Kevin Johnson took the fake.
Donovan McNabb's going to fake the reverse to Kevin Johnson. But again, he shows you his 6'3", 220-pound frame. Bench presses over 350 pounds. The strength as he runs into that pile.
McNabb's touchdown pass earlier put him past Glenn Foley, the all-time Big East touchdown pass thrower with 62.
A little too slow getting to the line of scrimmage, Mike.
Down 21 with 8:20. The clock is not your friend. McNabb option with Conrad leading. McIntosh is taken out. Oh, great play by Clayton White again. He has really handled his part of the field very well tonight.
Young football players on defense. Clayton White's a redshirt sophomore. We've seen Edric Smith, LeVar Fisher, two freshmen. Jeff Fisher, a redshirt sophomore. It's a young defense for North Carolina State. The only good thing that happened for Syracuse there was the ball went out of bounds.
Stopping the clock with 8:08 to go. One back, three receivers, one tight end.
You figure Kevin Johnson here, he's been the go-to guy all night for him.
McNabb rolls, looks for the tight end, and now in the back of the end zone finds Spotwood, who was out of the back of the end zone.
It's a lack of concentration, Mike. You see the frustration again on Donovan McNabb.
Quinn Spotwood all alone in the back of the end zone. It looked like he took a step back when he caught the football. And he is a very good football player.
Correct call by James Anderson, the back judge. Didn't get either foot in. Hobbled by a bad knee on crutches on Monday. Treatment during the week, limping a little bit now. Pride hurt as well.
Well, they got wasted time out here.
And I think the delay of game comes before that. Nope, got the timeout instead. Stepping out with him just inside of, or just outside of 8 minutes, rather, left in the game. Paul Pasqualoni's team down to one timeout. And when you have veterans and experienced seniors, and guys who've won in front of the biggest on-campus crowd in the history of the sport at the Big House, you'd expect them not to be rattled. But Mike O'Kane's team has proven once again against ranked opponents how good they are. Out of the end zone, incomplete, no chance for Johnson to make the catch.
Mike, that play just didn't have a chance because it was thrown too late by Donovan McNabb. They ran out of football field. Kevin Johnson, the intended receiver, the inside receiver, running a corner route. Now, this is the play before when the throw to Quentin Spotwood. But the last play just waited too long.
Obviously going for it on fourth and goal. Darryl Daniel is in the game along with Spotwood. Adrian Wilson comes up with the interception, 12th interception of the year for NC State, and the young guys on their turf have beaten the experienced guys tonight.
What a great memory for Adrian Wilson. Young freshman, the veteran Syracuse football team, Donovan McNabb trying to get the ball to Rob Conrad, and another freshman with the interception.
They had freshmen on the field in the red zone against Florida State in big moments, and Mike O'Kane's kids answered the call. And they're doing it again tonight. You don't want to say what if, but what if they could have gotten off to a better start against Baylor? Rashawn Spikes picks up the first down at the 15. NC State keeps moving the chains. We welcome those of you who watched the Atlanta Braves down to their last couple of outs rally to beat the Cubs 2-1 and take a 2-0 series lead. What the Cubs are feeling is what Kyle McIntosh and the Syracuse team is feeling. A double-digit favorite, number 11 in the country, came in, walked down the field on their opening drive. It was 7-0, and then North Carolina State scored 31 of the next 34. Doing it all, offense, defense, special teams. They've completely outplayed Syracuse, and NC State is on its way to doing something few teams ever do. They are going to beat two top 11 programs as an unranked team on their field in the same year.
And Mike, they've had help tonight for this crowd. This crowd has been very vocal and supported this young football team. Their rushing game came back. They're only averaging 93 yards rushing coming into this football game with Syracuse tonight. They've had a good ground game, a good plan by Michael Kane.
And they're super on the ground. They're now over 200 yards rushing as Spikes takes it out to the 20-yard line. Remember, North Carolina State did lose at Baylor, but that's a non-conference loss, obviously. They are 1-0 in the ACC. And more importantly, with a ground game that's starting to turn itself around, a passing game that is almost unstoppable with Holt and Chris Coleman, they've knocked off the big guy in the ACC. And the ACC defensive coordinators just asked George DeLeon about how tough this state offense is to deal with. Right out of the gun on 3rd and 5, Barnett walked it forward for 15. They are 9 of 13 on 3rd down tonight.
and they're over 500 yards.
The young guys are getting the better of the defensive. Syracuse guys, there's the trap right here on the draw. Alex Rice with a good block, and Mike, the veteran football team in here, Syracuse tonight, has been showed up by the young football team of North Carolina State. Freshman, sophomores, Ray Robinson on offense, redshirt junior quarterback Jamie Barnett.
Handing to Rashawn Spikes, who busted out from midfield. This drive started at the one. And they are just lining up, smacking Syracuse in the mouth, and running forward, led by this guy, who for the second straight year, in performance and stats and everything else, has outplayed Donovan McNabb.
And he said, coming into this game, he told Jerry Punch that gave him the confidence in beating Syracuse last year and beating Donovan McNabb, that he felt like he could lead his football team. Well, he's led him again to another victory over Syracuse.
I'll show you where he showed me the most in watching their game against Baylor. He threw for 469 yards in the second half. Yes, Holt made great plays and got open, but the throws were right there from Barnett after making mistakes in the first half and falling behind 26-0. Harold Jackson's second collegiate carry. The redshirt freshman gets stopped.
Mike, you talk about that Baylor game, and people probably try to figure out how can you beat Florida State, and then you beat Syracuse, and you go down to Baylor and lose, and that's nothing against Dave Robertson's Baylor team because they played well. But what happens when you beat Florida State, everybody slaps you on the back all week. You go to class, you go to the cafeteria, everybody tells you how great you are, and you live in that moment, the Florida State moment, a little bit too long, and you get in that ball game, and it's not like a spigot where you can turn it on and off.
Ray Robinson, the freshman, bouncing and pinballing forward, but he lost the ball, and Jason Coles has recovered another fumble tonight.
Marlon Greenwood made that play and pulled that ball out.
Look ahead here for NC State. I mentioned the ACC being 1-0, all conference games the rest of the way. And yes, Virginia's an excellent team in this conference, and there are good teams left, but they've knocked off the king. So everything from this point on, they have the confidence to know they can do because they beat Florida State.
They're one game up.
Yep.
And they've got, except for Virginia, they've got, and Clemson on the road, and of course Maryland, they've got the tough teams at home here. Georgia Tech's improving. Duke played a tough game last week. November 7th, Wake Forest team is an improved team. And North Carolina will get it together as they get their injured players back. And Oscar Davenport and Curry become better and better to quarterback position. So it's going to be a wide open league race.
And even if NC doesn't get it together, UNC, that rivalry game is one of the all-timers. Jerry knows that very well, and the man he's with knows it very well also.
And indeed, on a night where the NC State offensive line has been impressive, how appropriate that they would honor at halftime the only Outland Trophy winner in NC State's history, Jim Richer, a three-time All-Pro, four Super Bowls with the Buffalo Bills. And Jim, what a night for you and what a night for Wolfpack football.
It sure is. It's been a wonderful night. I'd just like to thank the Wolfpack fans for honoring me tonight. Although it seems like I'm really just a representative of all the great teams and all the great players and all the great coaches I got to play with. It's a team effort, and that's why I feel I'm just a representative of all that.
One of three NC State graduates in the College Football Hall of Fame, along with Ted Brown and Jack McDowell. Coming back here, not much has changed. It's still winning football, and Michael Kane's done a pretty good job.
I think he's done a great job. It's been a great effort tonight, and, you know, it just goes to show you just keep at it, and good things will happen.
They have rushed for 248 yards tonight, sort of reminiscent of the days when you were opening the big holes up front for some of the great running backs.
Well, Ted Brown was here. It was easy to block for a guy like Ted Brown. And, yeah, it does look a lot like that today.
Hey, Jim, congratulations. Thanks for joining us, and good luck.
Well, thank you. And I'd like to wish my sister a happy birthday. Happy birthday, Lori.
All right, Jim Richer, who is now a pilot, by the way, an airline pilot after a well-stellar career in the National Football League. Mike?
Jerry, thanks. You mentioned Richer, one of the four jerseys retired. Roman Gabriel, Dick Christie, and Ted Brown mentioned earlier are the other three. Good days with the Buffalo Bills.
Dead ball.
And our colleague
ball
now, Jim
start.
Kelly.
Offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat the down.
Doc's smiling like a Cheshire cat. He's waiting for you after the ball game.
Good. Well, you know what the wager was. Doc now has to buy dinner for us. That'll be the first time this year that we get Doc to go in his pocket and avoid the group on the road.
Syracuse will play next at home on the Deuce a week from Saturday against Cincinnati. The Bearcats off to a struggling start, and Syracuse lose this game. This is very similar to last year. They are still very much alive as they are undefeated within their conference to be the Big East champs. It's been the last 2 years. Pass complete to Darryl Daniel, the senior, to the 47. Well, the ACC getting its second victory over the Big East this year. BC won at Georgia Tech. Virginia Tech won at Clemson. West Virginia beat Maryland. The Big East was 3-0, but Maryland beat Temple last week. And this victory here tonight as Syracuse continues to self-destruct. There are two more games ahead, or three more, I should say, that are Big East against the ACC. Florida State's at Miami in October.
Ball start. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Defeated.
Pittsburgh comes down this way to play North Carolina and Virginia Tech on the Saturday after Thanksgiving. Well, SportsCenter's coming up as soon as we're done. Dan Patrick and Kenny Mayne. The latest update on Darryl Strawberry, and our thoughts and prayers are with Darryl. The National League Division Series recap from Turner Field in Atlanta. Complete reaction and the Astrodome as well. McNabb's pass is high and incomplete. The SportsCenter coming up, and right after that, baseball tonight with Carl and Peter. And Al Leiter gets you ready for the Friday action in the baseball playoffs. We're on the air at 3:30 tomorrow from Fenway. Baseball tonight first, then Sox-Indians pivotal game three.
Mike, we have a good ball game on Saturday night. Jim Donnan taking his Georgia team down to play Jerry DiNardo's LSU football team. The young, powerful Georgia team, they're going to run up against a real experienced LSU football team. It's tough at home.
McNabb to Conrad on second and 15. Rob's been relatively quiet tonight. Had an outstanding game at Michigan. His pass catching and his blocking.
Wearing the famous 44, Paul Pasqualoni said a couple of recruits have asked him on the telephone about that number, who will get it next in the recruiting battle.
We told you the great players in Syracuse past that have worn that number. McNabb's pass is incomplete as Conrad slipped. It's a number that is all over the campus, not just the football team and football jerseys, but it's a drinking establishment on campus. It's the zip code 13244. It's the first two digits of the phone numbers at the university, 443. Back to Jerry Punch.
People here in Raleigh are not only excited about the rise of the football program, but also the rise of some of the new buildings here just outside the Coliseum at Carter Family. The new Entertainment and Sports Arena, $157 million complex, that'll be the home to Wolfpack football and Hurricanes hockey. That building adjacent to the stadium here, it will be the state-of-the-art. As you see McNabb diving for yardage, it will be the state-of-the-art facility. State-of-the-art facility here anywhere in the country. They have gone all over the nation to build what will be a 20,000-seat arena for basketball and hockey, a multi-purpose facility, a cooperative effort for NC State, the state of North Carolina, of course, and the city of Raleigh. What an effort for this new arena.
McNabb picked up the first down, now goes deep for Jeff Lowe, and the pass is incomplete. Jerry, it is just to our left as we sit here in the press box at the stadium. And we got a tour yesterday in hard hats and all, a chance to check out the facility. It's a nice fitting hard hat, huh?
It's a company-issued
hard hat.
Look good. Mike, while we got
Wait a minute. Now, while we got you guys who look just as bad in your hard hat.
Hey,
I'm getting crushed.
While
tonight.
We got time, let me just tell you, it's been a real honor and a pleasure to work with you. And it's my last Thursday with you and Jerry Punch and Tim Corrigan, this whole crew, and it's been great. I'm going to miss you guys. I'm going to send you some pizza next Thursday in honor of me not being there.
Thank you. Let's talk for a minute here about this hat.
My hat.
What is that, Mike? That's good. Nice hat style. It's kind of blowing in the wind this way. That is awful. Look at Doc, though. Doc knows what he's doing with that hat. This is on and comfortable. McNabb fires to Johnson as they move inside the 25. We have absolutely enjoyed having you here, Mike, as well. It's been a lot of fun for Doc and I. We will miss you. Ron and Adrian, they get your dinners that you buy on the road every week. It's the nice thing you do.
I am going to miss you. And as I said before, it's an honor. You've been great, and we've had a lot of fun.
We sure have. Lots of airports and good games and good times. It really has been fun. Pass broken up by NC State.
On first down, Lloyd Harrison makes the stop. We were talking before, as we've traveled around and you travel on Fridays to go to the primetime games every Saturday, because of the great boom in baseball and the NFL start of the season, college football has gotten off to a slow start this month. And maybe because there aren't so many superior teams, but you think this is going to build in this next month of October?
Yeah, I think there's some big games coming. A lot of good college football ahead. Starting with Ohio State this weekend, we've got a good ball game. Tennessee goes into Auburn, and don't be surprised if Auburn knocks off Tennessee this weekend.
Come on, you're kidding.
I'm telling you, Auburn's got a great chance. The trap is set for Tennessee. Auburn had 2 weeks to prepare for them. If they can run the football, they've got a good shot of beating them.
12th play of the Syracuse drive from the 16. McNabb fires. Another receiver fell down. Another DB fell down.
That's been the kind of game for Syracuse. But Tennessee's a loaded football team. And it's going to be a difficult task, but that upset's possible.
Tennessee went up to the Carrier Dome to start the season and beat Syracuse by one on a field goal at the gun. But Torrey Holt has grabbed the headlines here tonight.
And he's in the Heisman hunt. If you're considering Heisman hopefuls, you better put Torrey Holt's name in there.
Fourth down. And there's your picture that says it all. If you were watching the baseball game tonight, you missed an absolute treat, because one star struggled, and in front of a great crowd here in Raleigh, NC State's entire effort, offense and defense, has been excellent.
Paul Pasqualoni will get his Syracuse team back. Michael Kane now has a ball club that's going to contend for the ACC championship. This says it all right here.
And how about the reaction of Torrey Holt, senior receiver who lived up to every bit of advanced billing tonight?
Came back because he wanted to graduate here at North Carolina State. And he will be a number one draft choice. I'm sure Mel Kiper's already preparing his name for the book.
Hey, this is such a strange sport and such a strange profession. But players like Torrey Holt can make it easy for a coach. There he is by game this year. Another game, three in a row, over 100 yards. And he didn't score a touchdown. But if you saw his effort, you knew how responsible he was for those 38 NC State points.
Maybe Doc can give that .com again down on the sideline for Torrey Holt.
The internet site on the web. Well, one of the guys you have to be happy for is Michael Kane. Wes Robinson, the athletic director, the former basketball coach at NC State, got a year.
At last.
Just to tell people that, hey, give Michael Kane a chance. And boy, did he get rewarded with a well-deserved contract. Quickly, Jerry.
And Les Robinson standing down here, he is the guy that had the vote of confidence last year. You had a vote of confidence in this coach to be able to keep him here, and now you're reaping the benefit.
Well, we certainly are, entire university. We've got a great coach and a great coaching staff and some outstanding young men, as they've seen all year here, and they're paying tremendous dividends now.
Les Robinson, a vote of confidence, and they're going to get a victory tonight for Michael Kane and the Wolfpack of North Carolina State.
Well, right? Les's budget, Jerry, is going to take another hit for the third time in four home games. They're going to bring down the goalpost here in Raleigh.
I don't think he minds.
6,000 a pop, but when you beat number 11 and you beat number 2 in the same season in back-to-back home games, it certainly is special. Torrey Holt was the man tonight. With Mike Godfrey and Dr. Jerry Punch, Mike Tirico, thanks for watching this presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. SportsCenter follows the break. The good rockin' daddy made sweet music here tonight.
Demonstrate your character, talk about build your teammates up, talk about them as a great program, make sure we're smart and showing our character. Wolfpack on three. One, two, three. Wolfpack!
NC State Wolfpack Football 98 with head coach Mike O'Kane and host Don Shea. NC State Wolfpack Football is brought to you by Gatorade. Is it in you? BB&T. You can tell we want your business. River Landing, private riverside living and world-class golf. Call 1-800-285-4171. And by Alltel. Cellular, paging, and long distance right down the street.
And yes, indeed, a happy group of Wolfpack football players, and well, they should be after putting the squeeze on the Orangemen. We have great game highlights. We're here at Carter-Finley Stadium where the goalposts are gone again for the second time in a matter of 3 weeks down Hillsborough Street and over at Fraternity Court. Great win for the Wolfpack. We also have our success story about a fella who can really tickle the ivories, and he's an award-winning composer. But before we get into the show, let's go to the locker room and hear post-game remarks from Coach Mike O'Kane.
It was a great win, team win. I mean, we won the kicking game, the offense defensively. It was just a great team win for us. And again, as I said, though, after the Florida State, you know, we've got to follow up. We've got to follow up. Had we done what we should have done at Baylor, I mean, we're sitting in a great position. We're still in a pretty good position anyway, but, you know, sitting here 4-0 as opposed to 3-1, you know, would have been a lot better.
NC State Wolfpack Football is brought to you by Optometric Eye Care, the official eye care provider for the Wolfpack. Kroger, always good, always fresh. Let's go Krogering. And by Bell South Yellow Pages, the real Yellow Pages.
Well, for the second time in 3 weeks, NC State has toppled a nationally ranked opponent. This time on this field here in Carter-Finley Stadium, the Wolfpack piled up 525 yards of total offense and dominated number 11 ranked Syracuse 38-17. Great win, Coach, and even more importantly, a great team win.
Oh, it was. Every phase of the game, we played very well. Special teams overall played well. Defensively, to hold them to 17 points was outstanding. Offensively, we scored four of the first four of times that we had the football. 28 points the first half. Just an outstanding team performance.
For the second week in a row, the offense has piled up more than 500 yards of total offense, so the O side of the ball seems to be clicking along rather nicely, Coach.
Well, we're doing some good things. We're making big plays. That's the name of the game. Jamie Barnett is the trigger to that. Had a great night last night. Plus, just played outstanding. Torrey Holt, the game breaker kind of player. But the thing that I was most pleased with last night is where we were able to get our running game going. I think we rushed for 240 yards and really control the line of scrimmage, particularly the second half. And I thought that was a key, that we were able to control the football, run some of the clock down, which helped preserve the win.
Let's look on the defensive side of the ball, where the Wolfpack held Syracuse 30 points below their scoring average. And here's a real great number, Coach, and that is they only converted one of 11 first downs.
It was a tremendous key last night. I think offensively we were like 11 of 16 third down or fourth down conversions, and they were only one of 11. And if you don't convert but one of 11 third down conversions, you're going to have a hard time winning. And when you're converting 9 of 15 or 9 of 16, then you're going to have a great chance of winning, because that's the key, is keeping the chains moving. And you do that by converting those third downs.
All right, thanks very much, Coach. Now let's show you how the Wolfpack got it done against Syracuse. Our first half highlights, sponsored by our banking friends at BB&T. The Pack trails 7-0 as we pick up Coach O'Kane.
We did a great job offensively answering Syracuse's first score on a big 3rd and 20. Jamie hits Torrey for a 40-yard completion. Again, a great example, starting a ball game with a big play, people making things happen. Jamie again on the severe pressure, finds Rashawn in the flats. Rashawn does a great job of catching the football, getting upfield, taking it down to the 6. Rashawn played very, very well last night, his best performance of the season. Got our option back involved in our offense. On a 3rd down and 6, we're able to get it in for the touchdown. Dan Deskovich comes in, kicks extra point, and it's a 7-7 game. Thought this was maybe the critical play of the ball game here. Tony Scott makes a great interception. Not only takes the ball away from them, but I believe it put a little bit of doubt into their mind. Put them back on their heels a little bit, gave our offense the football in great field position, and we were able to convert here very quickly with Torrey Holt on a little flanker screen. Then again on another third down, we come back to Torrey again. Jamie does a great job here of buying some time, finding Torrey, and Torrey goes up and makes a great catch to set us up for our second touchdown, and Jamie takes it in on the option once again for the touchdown, and we go up 14-7. Dan comes in and kicks the extra point. Again, our defense does a good job. We flush McNabb on a third down here, makes him have a bad throw, and we're able to take over. I think we took over offensively and punted it back to them. Then here on the reverse, we had it played pretty well, but you can see the speed of their guys. Great play by Jason Perry chasing it down, prevented the touchdown, and in turn kept them out of the end zone. Here on the third down, they get a drop pass in the end zone. We force them to kick a field goal and scores 14-10. Thought the effort by Jason Perry there was critical, that we stop them there, force the field goal, and then here we get the kickoff from that. Eric Leek brings it back about 22, 23 yards to set our offense up again. Here Jamie on the, I think it's a third and two, pulls the ball down. I thought Jamie did a tremendous job of making the right decisions when to pull the ball down and run, had some big runs for us. Third and two here, Torrey on a nice completion. Their defensive back falls down. Another third down conversion there. Fourth and four, Jamie keeps it on the option for a 21-yard gain. And then first down and 10, Jamie hits Ryan Hamrick for the touchdown. We go up 21-10. Critical stretch there with our offense, making things happen. We force a bad pitch on the option, which forces their offense into a long yardage situation. I thought a defensive front did an outstanding job last night of putting pressure and then making the play on McNabb. Jamie again making a great decision, pulls the ball down and runs for a 19-yard gain, which keeps our offense going. Ray Robinson, who was able to play a little bit more last night on the counter play for 9 yards. Again, Jamie to Chris Coleman, who played also played an outstanding game. A great catch on the sidelines, then tiptoes down the boundary for a big gain of force. Jamie to Chris again. I think they blew a coverage there, had a wide open receiver. And Chris just shows you there, you know, he's a big, strong young man, can run after catches of football. Jeff Butler, who played well for us, takes it in a great surge by our offensive line. And we go up 28-10 at the end of the first half. Here on a little screen, Edrick Smith smells it out and makes a tackle. Thought we had a chance here. We tackle McNabb. He fumbles the football. That ball seemed to lay on the ground forever, and nobody could get there. But that was the last play of the first half, and we go in at half 28-10.
Well, it's been all Wolfpack the first 30 minutes. They lead 28-10. Now let's go back to Carter Finley Stadium and Coach Mike O'Kane.
It's critical that we come out in the second half and set the tone again and make sure we have that same intensity. Jamie on the third and six gets Eric Leek, makes a fine catch there. Jamie again buying time, making things happen. Jamie again here stepping up, finding Torrey Holt on a 30-yard completion. Inside play to Jeff Butler, who I said earlier really played well last night. And then we come in and kick a 31-yard field goal. And that was a critical stage of the game. We need to come out and make something happen offensively and set a tone, and we're able to get points. So it was very, very important. Great push by our defensive front, great coverage by our secondary to make McNabb hold the football there. We're able to get one of our three sacks of the night. Again, flushed him out of the pocket. Great play by LaVar Fisher there. Tackle him for a 1 yard gain. That's a tremendous play by a defensive player against that individual. Again, they get the ball back after a fumble, first and goal. They throw a touchdown pass, makes the score 31-17 at the time. And again, it's critical. We do some things offensively. Again, Jamie buying time for Torrey. Coming back again. Great catch on the third down by Eric Leek. It was really nice to see Eric step up and make those two big catches. Clayton White, who I thought played an outstanding ball game, on the option there, making the play. Then we get great pressure. Jeff Fisher keeps going. Clint Johnson and Jeff Fisher back again for the sack and an 18-yard loss, which is a critical part of the ball game. They can end up having a short punt. We get the ball back and take it down with Ray Robinson on two plays here. a little counter play, and then back with the little delay underneath, takes it down to the 5-yard line, and then Jamie is able to take it in on a play action pass. They get it, they cover us. Jamie again, smart thing, pulls it down, takes it in the end zone. It's 38-17 at that point in time, and then our defense steps up. Again, another sack here. A good push by our defensive front, good coverage. Great play on the option by Clayton White, stringing it out. Edrick Smith making him pitch it, and then Clayton pitching out of bounds. And then coming here, Adrian Wilson for an interception that takes away their touchdown threat. And offensively, I thought we get the ball on the two, able on first down to get it out from the shadows of our goalposts, get a 13-yard gain by Rashawn. Again, Jamie on a 3rd and 5, picks up 20 on the quarterback draw. I thought Jimmy Kaiser and offensive staff did a great job of calling plays, as well as our defensive coaches getting our players in position to be successful. And this is a great football team that we played last night. And I have tremendous respect for Coach Pasqualoni and his staff and what they do in that football team. And we beat a very good football team.
Well, certainly a solid win for the Wolfpack, and just for the record, NC State is now 6-0 against Syracuse in their series. Well, it's that time of the program where we select our Bell South Yellow Pages player of the game. That's when I pass the ball to Coach.
Well, it's a very difficult decision, but I like it when it's difficult.
Absolutely.
It means you've got a lot of guys playing well, and we did. We had a tremendous number of players last night that played well on both sides of the football. But I believe the key to our winning was Jamie Barnett. He made the right decisions, pulled the ball down and ran, scrambled, avoided sacks. They brought tremendous pressure. He was able to avoid the blitz, find open receivers, had over 350 yards total offense. A tremendous individual performance by him, which led to our victory.
All right, thanks very much, Coach. Certainly can't argue with Jimmy Barnett as the Bell South player of the game. Now let's move on to Let's See That Again, sponsored by our friends at Optometric Eye Care Center. Early in the fourth quarter, Syracuse went from a 2nd and 6 to a 3rd and 39 as a scrambling McNabb under heavy pressure was sacked by defensive tackle Jeff Fisher. That's one of 3 sacks recorded by the Wolfpack.
NC State Wolfpack football is brought to you by Raleigh Community Hospital, celebrating 20 years of service in the same location and a legacy of compassion and care since 1914. And by PCS Phosphate, a proud corporate sponsor of the Wolfpack.
And welcome back into Wolfpack Football 98. Now let's check in with Renee Simmons for today's Kroger Gameplay Special.
Hi, Wolfpack fans. Welcome to Gameplay. Today we're going to be making marinated cheese. We're going to start by making the marinade, which is 1 cup of oil. And I'm putting it in a bowl, but sometimes I go ahead and put it in a mixer cup, which I will do at the end, and you'll get to see that. 1 cup of white wine vinegar. 1 jar of diced pimentos drained. Let's see if I can get those out of there. Three teaspoons of dried parsley. Pour in there. 3 tablespoons of minced green onion, and that's usually about 1 stalk, so you don't really have to measure that. 3 cloves of minced garlic, 1 teaspoon of sugar, 3/4 of a teaspoon of dried basil, and 1 teaspoon each of salt and pepper, and I have them mixed here so that they would just go in together. Then you would take this and pour it into a mixer cup, or you may go ahead and put it in a mixer cup right off the beginning, and it fills it up. We'll put the little top on, seal it tightly, and shake it really well so that it mixes up together. Once we have the marinade made, we will go and cut our cheese. We start with cream cheese and cheddar cheese, and usually I use sharp, and these are just your standard cheeses out at the grocery store. And we'll slice it lengthwise first, straight down the middle. It is best if the cheese has been very chilled. It'll slice much easier. And then you take little tiny squares that will be about 1/4 of an inch thick, and they'll look like this. And it doesn't have to be precise. We'll go to the cheddar cheese and slice it down the center also. And the main reason they don't have to be precise is you're going to be putting the marinade over the cheese, and it will hide all your imperfections, and they'll actually kind of look nice because it'll show through the marinade. We'll slice these, again, about a quarter of an inch thick so that you have little slices, and you slice all that together. Then you arrange it in a platter or something that you can cover and put in the refrigerator so that the cream cheese and the cheddar make a beautiful pattern in your bowl. Then you'll take your shaker and your marinade and mix it up just a little bit and pour it in gradually over. We'll put this in the refrigerator. We'll cover it overnight. Sometimes I use a plastic container to put it in. And you'll shake all of this out. It's really pretty at Christmas time, as well as the tailgating. Once your cheese has been in the refrigerator overnight, just transfer it to a platter of your choice. If there is any remaining marinade in the refrigerated bowl, just scoop it out and pour it over the cheese. Put it on a platter with crackers or whatever you would like to serve it with, and then it is ready for tailgating. Enjoy your football season and enjoy your marinated cheese.
All right, thanks very much, Renee. Renee, the wife of tight ends coach Brett Simmons. We had a call earlier in the week on Coach Michael Caine's radio show from a fella. He said, hey, even guys can prepare these recipes. That's right. That's why the coaches' wives make them quick and simple. And if you'd like to get one of the recipes we've had on over the past several weeks, just access the internet, www.gopack.com. Well, he's a longtime friend of mine. He's a former NC State student, and he's known to millions of people as an award-winning composer and the co-host of Entertainment Tonight. Here's Marie Lundberg with The Tall Blonde.
Cheers and applause greet musician John Tesh wherever he performs. His unique blend of jazz, rock, and classical melodies has won the hearts of fans worldwide in addition to four Emmy Awards. But long before he was filling concert venues, John Tesh was a student at North Carolina State. While living in North Carolina, he began his broadcasting career at radio station WKIX. One of his co-workers then was WRAL-TV news anchor Bill Leslie.
It's just so funny, though, to think about how the program director and others said, you know, I don't think this guy's going to make it, but we'll take a chance with him anyway, you know. Gee, look what he's done.
John Tesh went on to a very successful broadcasting career, but he always continued to make music. Many of his songs have sports themes, like Round Ball Rock, which NBC uses on its telecasts of NBA games. Gymnasts often use Tesh's music for competition or exhibitions, but his favorite themes are inspired by those close to his heart.
Of late, the songs that I've written that I'm most proudest of are the ones that I've written for my family, either for my wife or for my little baby girl, or just for being a happy guy, you know. And I think it was the New York Times that called me a doofus not too long ago, there is a part of my life where I am sort of a very, very clean cut, happily married, happy dad, and if in this day and time that makes you a doofus, then that's exactly what I am.
When he returned to North Carolina on tour, John invited his friend Bill Leslie to perform with him for a very special audience.
To come back to North Carolina to do that, in the area where I spent so many hours at North Carolina State, in the bowels of the practice rooms there, and just hammering out songs and trying to make it as a musician, it means a lot to me to come back there, because I just really want to sort of show off, I guess. Just say, this is what you guys gave me, and I want to show it off for you.
John Tesh is one of the hottest concert performers in the country. His albums sell millions of copies, and his face can even be found on cereal boxes. But success hasn't changed him at all.
He's still the same warm, whimsical kind of guy who still has that sense of determination about him, but still, the whole package is just a real charming fellow who cares about other people and has a wonderful gift.
Is there anything that you haven't done yet, either in music or in broadcasting, that you really still dream about accomplishing?
I love coming up with ideas that just evolve. And I don't have a thing like, well, in 10 years I want to be here, or in 20 years I want to be there. I'm just sort of taking it one day at a time. And when you do that and you do your very best and you have a lot of fun at it, especially in something like music, everything just seems to work out.
This is Maria Lundberg reporting.
Well, now the Wolfpack gets down to serious business, and I say serious business because from here on in, the next seven games are all conference games, and the first game of that stretch starts against Georgia Tech this Saturday, 3:30, right here in Carter-Finley Stadium. Our River Landing scouting report, what can you tell us about the Jackets, Coach?
Well, I don't know a lot other than that they played a great game against North Carolina, and I haven't seen that film yet or did not get to see the game, but if you score, I think they had 43 points against North Carolina. That's a tremendous performance by their offense. To hold them to, I think, only one offensive touchdown is a tremendous performance by their defense. It's going to be a very tough ball game. Every game that we have is going to be tough. You know, we're not going to out-talent people. We've got to play hard and play with a lot of emotion. And that's why it's critical that on Saturday that we have a packed house here. We had a great crowd last night against Syracuse. We've got to have a great crowd on Saturday, yelling and screaming, this place needs to be full, and wear red and yell for the Wolfpack.
All right, Coach, good luck against Georgia Tech.
Thank you very much, John.
All right, that's our show for today. Thanks for joining us. On behalf of our great television crew, Don Shea for Mike O'Kane, and you heard what the coach said, be here, be red, and be loud. We'll see you next week here on Wolfpack Football 98.
NC State Wolfpack Football with Coach Mike O'Kane and host Don Shea has been brought to you by Infinity, own one and you'll understand. By Kanawha Insurance, sound protection, peaceful settlements. And by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Your appearance tells people who you are, where you are in life, and most importantly, where you're going. Your image is paramount, and Hunter & Lords understands these things are important. That's why Hunter & Lords is the premier custom tailor in the nation. Kenny Doyle currently serves clients from Raleigh to Charlotte. Call Kenny if you appreciate fine tailored clothing.